I'm recording.
Hey, I'm totally tired.
Should I stop? Should I stop?
No, just keep going.
No, keep going. And welcome to another episode of Tea Time with LOTA.
I'm not even joking, I was looking at your cock the entire time.
I get that a lot.
I was actually seeing if there were actually two dicks down there. Alright, I know we just released an episode of Tea Time with LOTA this past week even, but I hit up Charlie and wanted to see if he would come down here on a Sunday, lazy Sunday afternoon and do a little interview. He's one of our favorite guitar players. I think I can make that assumption for everybody.
Absolutely. Easily.
Yes, yes.
You know how weird it is to fanboy over your own friend? Like,
extremely.
It's so strange. I consider us friends. I don't know. If Bessie is probably like, you're a dick. I hate you.
You're
brown.
A dick. I hate you. No,
no, but like every single time, anything he uploads, I'm like, oh, with stroking motions involved. Just, I don't know.
Does your woman, is she all right?
Is she aware of your problem?
Is she okay?
She knows.
Anyways, I wanted to get him down here so we can interview him, ask him some questions, find out his history, find out why he's so damn good. And all of that. So, let's get it started. You're in two projects right now.
Yes.
The User Lives and Transient Dawn. And let's go back to the beginning.
Okay.
Where were you born, raised, all that nonsense? Okay. I'm talking the beginning.
Okay, prehistoric Charlie here.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
So, I was actually...
Dinosaurs.
Exactly. I was actually born and raised here in Reno, Nevada. Well, I guess we're in Carson right now, but...
Right,
same thing.
But they don't know that.
They
now they do.
Yeah.
Son of a...
Yeah, so that 50-mile difference, so...
It's like 26.
Is it?
Oh, yeah, with the overpass.
Right, right. So, yeah... Born and raised in Reno, Nevada, started playing guitar when I was like 13.
How old are you now?
I'm 23, so 10 years ago.
Motherfucker.
Wow. God damn it.
What
was I
doing with my life when I was 23?
I fucking
nothing. I was dropping out of college when I was 23.
Yeah.
Damn. Anyways, okay, so
I was
13 is, so you're in, is that junior high?
No, that, or,
beginning,
yeah, yeah, school? I was right at 7th grade,
right.
So yeah.
You're
yeah.
on the cusp of high school.
Right, exactly, right. Yeah. And, yeah, I started playing guitar. I originally started just because, like, I wanted to, like hit on chicks and be like, hey, let's
of course.
Play guitar.
Yeah,
like,
of course.
This shitty Ivanes starter pack. Look how cool I
am. But they don't know that.
He's the dude with the acoustic at college parties.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to be that cool. I was never that cool. but, yeah, I just, like, I was, like, really into, like, System of a Down early on. And, like, I don't know, like, something about System of a Down made me really want to play guitar. Like, I had heard, like, other metal bands and stuff like that. I wasn't, like, really interested. And then, like, System of a Down happens, and I'm just like, oh, like, that's so wacky and crazy. Like, I'm super into that stuff. Like, my buddy Robbie got me into System of a Down. And then, like, I saw that he had played guitar, and, like, he was picking up all these chicks.
Your friend Robbie?
Yeah, yeah. He was picking up all these chicks just because he played guitar. And I was like, oh, my God, like... If only I had just had this cock magnet, or sorry, pussy magnet.
Freudian slip. Listen, okay, we have to address this. Are you coming out right now?
This is
on
like
our
literally
show?
The closet of like for the internet. Like, if you
come
didn't know, I was gay for like 5 minutes in 7th grade. And then I decided that no, that this tool would be used for vagina.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, so pussy magnet.
Pussy magnet.
I don't know how much that shook, because our cameraman is losing his shit.
Yeah, he's just like, oh my god.
The camera, we're sorry for any shakiness in the video.
Nothing is in focus anymore.
He instantly let go of the camera and just pointed.
He's just like, faggot.
Freudian slip.
Watch now, everybody's gonna like think that picture I posted on my Facebook not long ago, where I'm like laying
go.
Down
oh,
like this.
Yeah.
Everybody's gonna be like, oh my god, the stars align.
It makes
alive.
Total sense.
I get it now.
Now whatever. The caption, hey boys, it makes
2 months before that, he said something about liking bears, and I thought he meant actual grar bears. Not actual fucking, oh my goodness, bears. Like,
he's the cub, he's looking for his bears. Alright, so here's the deal. Number one. Gay, straight, I don't care. Duke is playing a hell of a guitar. But, straight. Just, ladies, pussy magnet. Okay, so here we go.
Get it straight.
Here we go.
There's a typo. Well, he's reading from a prompter.
So
back to seventh grade.
Back to seventh grade. I get the Ibanez starter pack. And like I get the Ibanez cock magnet.
It's right on the side.
It's right on the side. And it comes with like a little starter amp, comes with a guitar, and like a shitty chord that died on me like 2 days later. And so I start playing this, and like I decide I'm gonna take it to school one day. So I take the guitar to school, and like I'm gonna be like my friend Robbie, like he's picking up chicks everywhere, and. I take it over there, and I'm like, nobody likes me, and, like, because one girl walks by, and she's like, because you fucking suck.
And your first on screen is like,
it hadn't dawned on you, you didn't know how to play the guitar. Right, you just thought if you sat there with it.
Like literally, a couple
girls would be like, here's the pussy, take some pussy, and you're like, thanks, pussy falling out of my pockets, please, sir, don't step on that, that's mine. Like,
because, like, literally a couple days prior, like, it was just, like, I didn't even know how to push the frets down on the guitar. I was just like strumming strings. Like
you didn't even ask Robbie for any lessons.
No.
In hindsight,
a little bit good thing to do. And then I met my buddy Griffin Eaton. I'm not in contact with him today. Like he's a super cool dude.
Griffin, if you ever see this, bro,
man, dude,
Charlie's been looking for you, man.
But
he hasn't been. That's the thing.
Been looking with looking for now. He is magnet.
He told me that it's actually cool to like get better at guitar. He started showing me bands like Slayer.
Because the chick that told you suck wasn't good enough.
Right. I needed Griffin. And, like,
fuck her.
Griffin,
she had flat tits anyway, bitch.
Griffin shows me bands like Slayer. He shows me Slipknot. All like the intro like bands for like a metalhead.
Right.
And then like I started
no Metallica.
I found Metallica from my guitar teacher.
Okay.
So
you need someone a little bit older to go over.
Right.
Band from the 80s.
Right. Jeff Montgomery at Bizarre Guitar. He showed me Metallica. And, like, I fell in love with that as well. So, like, all those, like, early, like, gateway metal bands, like, I was, like, super in love with. And, that started getting me, like, on the path to, like, getting better at guitar. Mm-hmm. Nice. So.
Did you listen to anything else? You said that you weren't really into metal. Right away, it was System of a Down that was your gateway.
Right, if you could call that.
What were you listening to in junior high?
No, absolutely, that's
that.
A gateway.
I guess, like, it was, like, you know, like...
Were you hip-hop? Were you...
No, it was, like, AC/DC, like, it was, like, more towards the rock area, like, some alternative.
Said AC/DC, I just wanted to see Phil's face, like,
this interview is over.
it is, granted, but, like... And, yeah, it was, like, AC/DC. I listened to, like, some, like, alternative that my, like, dad showed me, like Cake and stuff like that.
Pearl Jam!
Like, not really Pearl Jam.
I'm just saying.
I was
an
really
alternative.
Bad.
I said Pearl Jam.
I was really bad at discovering music prior to, like, being good at guitar. Like, I didn't know, like, I would rather play video games all day.
So you weren't even into music so much, but then when you saw Chick Magnet, or that idea popped, all of a sudden you're like, music.
Right.
It's a thing.
Yeah, it's totally a thing. Okay. And, like, then, like, I gotta say,
I really admire that.
It became, like, you know, less about, like, impressing people and more about me just wanting to be better, mm-hmm. like, after a while. Like, because, like, there was a while where I was, like, struggling and I'm just like, I don't really want to just, you know, play power chords all day. Like, that wasn't really my thing. And a big band that, like, opened me up, like, to more, like, artistic side of things was, like, Cradle of Filth.
Mm-hmm.
And I just saw like the cool like orchestration that they did and like how like the guitars weren't necessarily the highlight of that band. It's like
sometimes the keys.
Like keys and like
vocal.
Most importantly the vocals.
Right.
Like I and
don't even say you can't get into that band.
Don't make this about you.
Like
Sammy.
It's totally understandable, like it's not for everyone.
No,
man.
Like, instrumentally, I think they're fucking
Yeah.
I just don't like Danny Phil's voice. That's all. I just don't
like
his voice.
Totally
I don't know why. I just,
I love Danny Phil. I think he's, like, brilliant. His lyricism is just, out of this world.
His lyricism is fucking incredible.
And, like, I would just be in my room all day trying to learn Cradle of Filth songs. Like, I was like...
Dude, I totally remember this. We had the... You posted something on Facebook.
Right.
I was saying, Damnation of Day is, like... That was my first taste.
Right.
And just the whole concept album and the Fall of Satan and,
right,
and all
right.
this Lucifer, sorry.
Right.
The Fall of Lucifer and it just all I'm just like, man, this is a brilliant album, man.
Right.
Musically and dude, one of my favorite like moments in metal ever is I think it's the third song, which I can't even tell you off the top of my head. But he does this the
kiss became on. And he just goes super high.
I can't name the song either. Yeah. You hadn't said anything.
But then when he hits that note, I get chills every single time.
Right.
But
sometimes the guy that they have like in the studio, they just like kicked him right in the balls.
Right in the neck.
There are some like myths going around like that are have like legitimacy or they can't be like debunked or anything like that, where like Danny Phil will like drink bleach prior to like studio recording.
God, to get that.
It probably is a myth. I'm just gonna put that out there, but I mean like if that was the case.
But let's add to it.
That's fucking metal. Like one girl.
Dedication.
Like he killed one girl.
Yeah.
Like
but
bleach and this motherfucker's over here like recording me.
Yeah, but Danny was no girl. So apparently he could just drink bleach and go to work.
There was actually a time, like, before I, like, knew any of the members, that I actually thought it was, like, a female vocalist. Just because, like, how, like, almost feminine, like, the higher parts are.
Yeah.
Like, the first
You're
album
super
I listened
smooth,
to...
smooth, that's why.
The first album I listened to was Nymphetamine. And, I remember the song Nymphetamine Overdose. It was, like, there's a section, like maybe, like, 1 or 2 minutes into the song that sounds extremely feminine. Like... And I was just like, is this a chick vocalist? And I like search like Cradle Filth, fuck, like I'm on the band page, and it's like, no, Danny Filth, and like total dude. And I see that they had a female vocalist on top of that. I'm like, no, it's her. She has to be doing all the high screams. And like then you see it live, and you're like, fuck, like
yeah, no, it's Danny.
Yeah,
no, it's amazing. I don't know, man. I'm sorry you don't get into. I feel bad.
It's just
the vocals. I literally feel sorry. For
yeah,
you.
No, it's just the vocals. I don't know why. I just they're not like my.
His theology, for lack of a better term, I'm not so much into that, but he's a good storyteller. He's a good songwriter.
Yeah, yeah, and I can totally, but I respect that.
You,
I think
yeah,
he's phenomenal.
And that's because I don't know,
just,
you know, I come from a Christian background.
Right, totally.
But obviously I'm not one of those people who's like, you have to believe what I believe or else you're wrong. I can listen to everything, and that's one of my big things is like, if I want someone to hear what I have to say in my songs, I better be willing to listen to what they have to say.
Right.
Yeah,
so that's
absolutely.
Why I have no problem with what he says. It's his deal. Same thing with Marilyn Manson. I don't believe in a lot of the same stuff he believes in, but dude knows how to write an incredible song.
And I think that's something that like all metalheads eventually overcome is like they realize a lot of it's fiction. Like they aren't actually taking what they're saying seriously.
Right.
Which, like, I actually love. I actually, like,
Motley Crue didn't really worship the devil.
I've had so many people get on my, I can't listen to Infant Annihilator because of the name and then
all
their songs.
Right,
the what?
Yeah, and I'm like, fucking relax.
Yeah, like, there's
literally
a song name called Dedication to Child Rape or something.
Yeah,
it's
no, it's
like,
Devotion to the Child Rape Syndicate.
Yes, yes, yeah.
And that's it's a fucking horrible title. Okay,
yeah,
look.
but
it gets them some attention. It gets them some listens.
Yeah.
So people are like, I gotta check this band out. So I can rag on him.
And it's funny because there was that whole thing, and I can't remember who the musician was, but like it was like maybe a little over a year, about a year ago, and he got caught like with, like he had just like molested like a 2-month-old or something, and then everybody plastered their name all over his thing, and they were like, "Oh, Infant Annihilator," and they flipped the fuck out.
Yeah.
They were like, "Don't you ever fucking tag us to anything like this? Don't you attach us?
Was
like all of the shit that we do is just for like shock." But don't you ever goddamn think
for a second that
this is okay.
I
know,
mean,
like,
at some point, you have to realize the repercussions of having those kind of names.
Right, yeah, no, absolutely.
The thing is like, it actually does more good for them than it does bad. I was,
bad press is still press.
I was talking to my guitar teacher, my most recent guitar teacher, Miles Baker, from Rings of Saturn.
Dude,
and,
holy shit! What?
Dropping bombs in
here. He's happened like 3 times today.
But,
no, I'm sorry.
Sky Blessings.
Yeah.
So,
holy... I'm sorry.
But,
if you guys have never heard Rings of Saturn, Alien Core is fucking insanity. I'm sorry.
It's
just need to get
it. I love Rings of Saturn, but, like, Lucas Mann, their other guitar player, is, like, extremely controversial.
I thought
in, like,
Lucas
the
was out. I thought he was
No. Joel Omen's left. Lucas is the founding member.
Okay.
But Lucas is, like, extremely, like, controversial within the music community. Like, he's been accused of, like, guitar-proing songs and, like, recording at half speed.
Exactly, and then speeding it up.
But he said, like, he told me that stuff, like, whether it's good or bad press, it's still press.
Mm-hmm.
And it builds the band up. It gets you fans regardless. Because,
yeah.
Like, a lot of people don't give a fuck. Like, they don't care if it's half speed. And stuff like that, and like whether it's legit, whether his playing is legitimate or not, he built a fan base based on that. Like,
can he play the songs live?
Yes, he can.
Can
they
play it good live?
Like, I know Miles can. I've never seen Lucas play live. I can't attest to that. I'm sure he's fine. But like Miles, like he's. Are you familiar with Interloper? Have you heard of Interloper?
No, I haven't.
Like Miles is crazy. Miles is 20 years old and like one of the best guitar players like out there. Like, he's so good. And so I have complete faith that he's going to, like, if they couldn't do it live, now they can. Like, so...
Half speed, if you, I don't, that's not the test. If you have to record at half speed, do you know how many tricks you have to do in the studio to get your album perfect where you want it to be? I've had my drum up when House Curse was in the studio, and I'd be doing double bass at 240 BPM, and there'd be one little eh.
Right.
Listen, I don't have to go back and record that again, because we play to a click, he can line it up, and he can go, okay, copy.
It's time
crazy. Good to go.
It's right. An industry standard. Like, yeah. People forget that, like, they're not above, like, tricks. Like, especially, like, because I know some people who, like, they talk way too much shit for what they can actually, like, attest to, you know? Like, I know some people who would, like, claim that, like, Lucas, man, you're a hack. You're a fucking, like, terrible musician. But, like, I'd argue, why wouldn't you want the best produced album you possibly can?
Right? Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Why would you not want people to be wowed instead of be like, oh, there's a fuck up there?
Oh, no, because this is an album. It has to be perfect. We don't want to hear your humanness in this.
At the same time,
humanity, I'm sorry.
One of the things I'm proud of is with the House Curse, you can hear some flaws in my playing. There's a little bit, and it's like, I'm not a fucking drummer.
No,
machine.
No.
And I'm, right. I'm happy
no, no, no.
about that. I'm
you
glad.
Can hear the flaws in your shit. I don't hear
yeah.
jack shit. I'm like,
I
want to be like
I
that.
I can hear it and I can go, oh, that shouldn't have been there. That should have been fixed and all that. And, but I'm happy because it gives that feel of, all right, it's not complete drum machine.
Human.
That's a dude
yeah, yeah.
that actually went in the studio and recorded his parts.
Right,
right.
So I'm completely fine with little mess ups here and there. But it doesn't mean it doesn't irk me. Like, fuck, I wish we'd fix that.
Yeah, like...
You know. But the people who take that and go, oh, well, no, it should have been perfect.
Yeah.
Like,
dude, I'll listen
go
to...
Go fuck
I'll,
yourself,
I'll have
dude.
Local
like, there's
bands
no way.
That'll let me hear their music before they put it out on CD.
Right.
And they'll be like, well, so what do you think? And I'm like, you fixed that part, didn't you? Like, I'll hear things and I'll be like, oh, it sounds too perfect.
Right.
I'm like, that was definitely fixed, wasn't it? And they're like, yeah.
Especially when you hear cymbals cut out that shouldn't. Like,
yeah.
or kick that's too triggered.
Like,
it's like you can tell that it's
screw recording drums, dude. Like, man, that's so hard. I don't know how you guys do it, because like you have to be perfect throughout the entire song. It's not like a guitar player where you can like track by track every single part. And like that's like I find drums to be one of the most respectable instruments. Like just because of that,
absolutely.
Like you need to be legitimate.
Are you guys hearing this?
Okay. Yeah, but, take that in, all right? I don't care if I'm not as good, just take it in.
I will say, back when I was in Uplifted, and we went in the studio, we didn't play the click because I was scared.
Right.
And so I'm like, I was intimidated by the click, and I would have to go from the beginning of the song to the end, and if I fucked up anywhere in the middle, if I was, like, four measures from the end and I fucked up, go back to the beginning, start over.
Right.
And I'm like, you know what? I'm good enough, my time is good enough, let's just patch it in. And it got to the point where he would just patch me in, even without a click.
Right.
And it would sound seamless.
Right.
I take so much pride. I take so much pride in being able to do that, you know? And
right.
then with the House Curse, it got to the point where we play with the click, but the guitar player would mess up.
Well, right.
So I've got his scratch track in here, and I'm like, you know what? Stop playing. I know my part.
Right.
And I would play to the click with no guitar and just
yeah.
play my drum part. And because they were fucking me up, and I'm like, no, you want to get this done sooner? Let me play without you guys. I've studied. I've practiced. I've rehearsed. I know what I'm doing.
And I totally get that. I mean, as like, I pride myself on my timekeeping abilities too. Like, as it's fucking hard. If
it's
you're
really hard. I don't play drums though.
It's like, so when you're a drummer, you have to keep time.
Mm-hmm.
You have no choice. So like, and sometimes I feel like it makes me come off as a bit of a dick if I'm talking to somebody and they're like, oh, I do it like this, and I'm like, that's wrong. And they're like, what? No, fuck you. And I'm like, no, I don't mean to say like you're fucking wrong and you suck. I'm saying that's just a little off.
Well, maybe just say it that way then. So you don't come off like
that.
No, it's just, yeah, exactly. I don't have a filter. It just comes out, and I'm like, ah.
And you know what I mean?
Like
I'm
that.
All about no filter. So
a metronome is just a musician's best friend in general. Like
in rehearsal, I would say yes, but in like live, I hate playing it. I wouldn't
oh,
want to.
Oh, I would
yeah.
never
want to. I wouldn't
yeah.
want to because I like the ebb and flow of a show.
Of like a live
yeah.
performance.
Yeah.
Yeah, I. Like, I can see where that comes off.
Do you guys
like,
play to a click?
We do. I,
okay.
like, and
cool.
What I'll say about, like, playing to a click is you can never make good enough pre-pros. Like if you can deck out your pre-pros as good as possible with guitars, bass, like, keys, all that stuff inside the drummer's heads when he's playing live, like, I think it just, like, adds for a more precise experience for everyone.
For people who don't know, who are maybe watching this that aren't in a band, tell them what pre-pro is.
So a pre-production is a representation of what your final recording should be.
So many people heard pre-production and they were like, oh.
Yeah, as soon as they hear that.
Go ahead, continue.
So, pre-production or pre-pro, just, it's like, it's a very low quality version of what you want your final product to be. And, what it's set up with like a click track, so a metronome that constantly keeps time, so that everyone is playing their parts in time, which is pretty important for a live setting.
Especially with tech
right,
band.
Right. Yeah. And like if like especially if your drummer is deviating in tempo or BPM, whatever you want to call it, it just adds to everyone's precision. It if what would be a pistol going off would be a shotgun if you have pre-pros, in my opinion.
Oh, okay.
Like, so it just adds for precision. But there's bands who stand by not doing pre-pros because they want the full immersion of like a live band, like a I know Stray from the Path, which is a hardcore band signed to Sumerian. They were talking.
You say that like, oh, why are they signed to Sumerian? But whatever.
No, I was just like thinking, what label are they on in Sumerian? Okay. But. They don't do click tracks at all live. They don't do any backtracking, no click tracks. So everything they do is just straight on live.
That's awesome.
Which
at the same time,
I can understand why people would want to use a click track live though, just to put on
and
like,
have the
music
pre-pro.
Sound.
Yeah, especially if you don't have a keyboard player and you're trying to get keys, it's necessary.
Right.
Yeah.
Like,
because it's got to sync up. Or
right.
if you have a samples.
Right. Exactly.
You need to have the click to be able to. Get everything inside.
Right, it depends on the project that you're going for.
Although, Tool, I don't think Tool plays with the click, and they're audio-visual dude.
Right.
It's different every time. They play, their set is different every time. They allow for the ebb and flow of the show, and their audio-visual dude has to be on top of
it.
Yeah.
If they're playing without a click live, that's remarkable, because like, Tool is like crazy. Like,
yeah,
so the
super,
change in time signatures
yeah.
that they go through for every song is like retarded, so... I would be very surprised to see if Tool actually did that. Like, I might go look it up after.
But this is what I was told before I went and saw them in Reno
right.
2 years ago, or whatever. I was told that their show is different every time.
Right.
Now, maybe they do program a click and they like okay, use click A for. The
I imagine
song.
They have like if you're a band as big as Tool, you probably have multiple different sets lined up for your click tracks.
Right.
Like,
so that might be possible, but. Then that takes away what I was told, what I read. Of course, you can't believe everything you read on the internet,
right.
but what I read, that the video, visual guy has to go on the fly.
Yeah.
If they know what their click is for their set, then he's got to know what their click is.
I'm sure he makes a lot of money, too.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm sure. Dude, that was such an amazing show, but I digress. Anyways, okay, so let's get back to, because this is already going to be like a 2-hour video.
Hold on. First off, I just...
Did you fart again?
No.
Okay.
I know everybody's like, I don't think we can hear that in the video. I'm like, oh, just you wait. No, but... you will. No, but my...
I went back.
We didn't even say any... I didn't... At the beginning... A lot of people don't know who the fuck you are.
Oh, I'm just
yeah.
I'm
just
everybody's like, who? Wait a minute, is
that's
that part of
back
LOTA? No, he's not.
Phil.
Okay, so just a quick
German people.
For those of you who know that, or it doesn't matter. For those of you who do or do not know that, we have a separate Phil and I have a separate project called A Machine Built for War. This is our bass player. This is my best friend Zeb. We've been friends.
Did you hear that? You're not his best friend. Zeb is.
Like,
I'm sorry, dude. Come back.
No, but
I'll be your best friend.
But he's our guest today too, and nobody introduced him. He's just been sitting here, kind of throwing an input every once in a while, and it just like hit me, and I'm all wasted.
That's bad form. You're right. I apologize.
No worries.
Because I kind of
no worries. I made these two perfectly aware that I'm okay being in the background today, considering the guest.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
I am totally fine.
So you're just here to learn.
Exactly.
Yeah.
To be in awe.
I'm a drummer. I'm here to learn.
Right.
So, and then who's filming for us?
Oh, of course, our fucking cameraman, 2Dig Nick. What up?
2Dig Nick.
Dude, I was so close. I could have been fondling him.
How did that nickname happen? Please tell me.
You don't want to know.
We don't know.
You don't want to
know. Look, man.
I'm imagining
alcohol
was involved.
No, here's the thing. So,
it's actually at work, so no.
2Dig,
wow.
Phillip, and myself work at U-Haul here in Carson City. And he's our boss. And one day, he was taking a piss, and I was unaware. And I walked into the bathroom, and he's peeing out of one, and the other one's just erect. And I was like, whoa! I had no idea how to react.
It's always like that.
And it was just this thing. Dude, I had no. It was the biggest.
You had to ask. You had to ask.
Well, it's just because so I can prepare the cock magnet, you know.
I need to know this. Awesome.
I still got that Ivan has started passing my closet. What up, girl? I mean, what up, Tune in?
All right. Okay. So let's focus back in. All right. So you're getting turned on to the music that's shaping and forming your guitar playing.
Yes, yes.
So far, Slipknots and
right. Like all those early ones, yeah.
Right.
And then, that sort of kickstarted me off. Like, that was, like probably my intro just to, like, you know, riffing and stuff like that, and just more than chords, strumming chords. And so that evolved into two bands that were, like, super influential to me, and that was Trivium and Darkest Hour.
Yeah!
And, like,
nice.
Like
Trivium rules!
Like,
I've recently discovered Trivium.
Trivium gets so much shit, but they're so good. Like,
they're only getting shit because people are starting to hear more about them when they put out their last album, which, in most people's opinion, wasn't that great.
I didn't listen to it.
Ascendancy, yeah, me neither. But
I
Ascendancy was...
Ascendancy
is their shit!
I still say Waves is a better record than people say it is.
No, I know,
I love In Waves.
I love In Waves. It's a phenomenal album, but I don't think anything's going to beat Ascendancy.
Right. The only shit I ever heard about that band is about how their dad had to pay... What label? Roadrunner?
Roadrunner, yeah.
Okay, they had to pay like $50,000 to get signed to Roadrunner.
Oh,
who
wow.
gives a fuck, man? Because
now
they're making
huge.
A shit
yeah,
ton
that
of
sucks,
money,
though.
You know?
Yeah.
Pay $50. It's like you having to pay $100,000 to get on Ozfest. Who cares? If you got a label behind... If someone
true.
Who wants to invest in you $100,000 to get you on there, they're going to make their money back.
Like,
plus...
Oh, absolutely.
It's an investment.
Yeah.
Like, no?
I don't know if you've seen how good Trivium lives on the road, but if you get a chance, like, search their I think it was Mayhem Fest that they played at, but they did a tour documentary for just Trivium, and they showed them at Mayhem Fest and, like, how decked out their bus is, like, the stage that they're playing on.
Oh, yeah.
Like, God, they made their money back if they paid $50.
But they're,
yeah,
but
yeah,
they're
yeah.
still but they're still super, like, approachable, very nice, humble guys.
Right.
It wasn't like they didn't have the talent.
Right.
If they paid
right.
$50,000... And Roadrunner said, hey, sure, I would lose all respect for Roadrunner. Because they signed a shitty band.
Right.
They're not a shitty band.
No.
Right.
The dudes can play their instruments. They write great songs.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, I'm surprised nobody ever called out Trivium for not, like, playing what they play. Because their guitar solos are retarded. They're so good.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
They're so fast. And, like, but, like, on that tour documentary, they showed them warming up and how fucking spot on they are. Like, you just wonder, like, oh, God, you dudes are inhuman. There's no wonder they're actually... There's no wondering why you're signed, like...
Yeah, absolutely,
yeah.
So you think maybe they could actually be playing more technical metal than...
Oh.
Than the radio-friendly stuff?
I guess the riffage is just probably the only part that's, like, not as technical about them, but, like, their guitar solos are, like, top-notch. Like,
right.
They're 10 out of 10. I mean, they...
You can see them easily go from, like, oh, man, these are catchy riffs and they're super fun, and then they play these solos that you're like, you could be in any of the fucking bands
right.
and not have a single issue... keeping up.
I guess
like,
yeah.
It's just like the elitist musician tech death crowd that's just like, oh, everything's at 4/4. Oh, everything's
yeah,
like...
Yeah,
I know, like, fuck
if it sounds good, it sounds good. Fuck off.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
Like...
That's how I feel. That's why I write most of my stuff in 4/4.
And then bring it to me and
especially
I'll,
if you're,
we'll
yeah,
adjust it to
yeah.
5 or 7 or something.
Yeah,
but he'll still play in 4/4 and you'll play in like 18/2.
I'm completely and, like, as long as he's able to play his 4/4 riff over and
well,
I'm not throwing him off.
The greatest thing about
whatever's best for
the like 13 purple.
The greatest thing about 4/4
loving the egg.
The greatest thing about 4/4 and 3/4 is that it's like vocally easy to sing to.
Yeah.
Like, if you're creating music for, like, vocals, like most bands do, I mean, how do you sing over 5/8 or, like,
right.
some retarded time signature, like, 11/8 or something like that? Like, it's just difficult and almost not worth the time, and it takes away from the songs when you
exactly.
add vocals to it.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I almost, like, stress that, like, not stress, I mean, that would make me sound like an expert, but, I would say...
he's totally not. Go ahead and look up his videos and tell me he's not an expert. I dare you.
But
I'll give you $5 if you can tell me that shit.
I'll do that right
now. I would
now.
Say, like, vocals, if you can keep it to 4/4 and 3/4, the better. Like, and if you're gonna make stuff that's in a bananas time signature, do it, instrumentally. Like,
yeah.
There are some, like, I like vocals in 7, who is it? Soundgarden does a lot of the vocals.
Oh, do they?
A lot of songs in 7, and not a lot, but they have more than the average like band in
right.
that style. And to me, 7 is just 8
8 minus 1.
Cut off just a little bit.
Yeah.
And so it adds for some interesting, and Matt Cameron being the fucking amazing drummer that he is, makes it feel like 4, I mean, or 8 or whatever.
Right.
And it's not.
Well, I guess that's where you get into like polyrhythms and making it flow as well.
And two against 3 is the easiest polyrhythm to do. So the 3 against 4, 2 against 3, that's the easiest one. Now when you're doing like 7 against the 5 against the 4 or something like that.
Yeah.
Like, who is it, Marco Miniman? I've got Marco Miniman's one of his instructional DVDs, and I don't watch it to learn. I watch it just to be like, fuck you, you're so
fuck Marco Miniman, dude.
9 against 7 against 5 against 4. Like, each limb is doing a different time signature, and I'm just
He uploaded a recent video to Facebook, Marco Miniman did, where he builds like some like octuple, quintuple, blah 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 bullshit on his drums, where he's like doing a pattern and just keeps adding on patterns with every limb, and I'm just like, you're retarded. How do you do
that's,
that?
That's like, part of the reason why I like Cameron Loesch as a drummer, because he does the same thing.
For what band?
For Born of Osiris.
Okay, sorry.
And, that dude's... dude, oh my god.
His footwork, just... so good.
Yeah, like, it's... he can do anything, and then he'll just do different time signatures for each limb, and I'm like, how the fuck do you do that? Like, and just keep... seamlessly, he just does it like... Oh, yeah.
Martin Cyrus has great musicians.
Oh, absolutely.
I'm sad to watch Jason Richardson.
Me too.
That dude out of this world.
Yeah. But it's not like Lee McKinney can't keep up.
Yeah, I mean, the like when he's not drunk, because there's that terrible video of him trying to do the what is it, the Follow the Signs guitar solo, and he completely botches it. And
it's
because live?
It was live.
That is terrible.
I think it's completely attestable to, like, he looked drunk when he was doing it, so I'm going to go on the limb and he said he was drunk, but I guarantee Lee McKinney is, like, an outstanding guitar player.
Yeah, I mean, when I saw them last, when they were here with Asking Alexandria and August Burns Red, we came as Romans, and he played the Follow the Signs fucking damn near perfect.
Right.
You know, he played the solo. He was sober. He was up there, dude. He just... and I was like, holy fuck,
the
man.
Fact of the matter is...
just that solo for that song itself is... fucking blew my mind the first time I heard it. I was like, wow.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
The fact of the matter is you're not going to have amazing shows every single time. You're
gonna
it's going to be something's going to... You know, he might have been playing... And I'm not saying in this case, but... he might have been playing and heard one of his strings was out of tune and he didn't get a chance to tune
literally
it beforehand
anything.
And it fucking throws him off, and you know, any little thing. My hi-hat has a tendency to drop.
Yeah,
and so I gotta play, instead of being able to open and close it, now I've gotta play the rest of my song with a closed thing.
Yeah.
Play with one hand while I'm trying to adjust this thing, and it totally throws you off, and so you're not gonna have 100% amazing performances every single time.
Right.
The show
being drunk...
Yeah,
that's your own damn fault.
Yeah,
the show I played with Transient Don on last Sunday. I still get that like rock in your stomach feeling, like, and like my hands get a little bit shaky, like, and I found some riffs that are just, you know, harder to play. Like, you're like not as on point as you want to be. Like, I remember sound checking, and I'm just like, oh, I'm gonna stop as soon as, like, I'm done sound checking, because, like, I'm not playing very well right now, but,
So what, not even warm up ahead of time?
Like, I warmed up in the back room ahead of time, like, way ahead of time, but, like, when you're sound checking on the stage, and, like, it's like, oh, this 100-something people in this room can totally hear my mess-ups, like,
right.
And you get self-conscious, and that, like, the nervousness, like, makes
snacks.
It even worse,
right.
Like, so...
Yeah.
So, okay, so... Asking you this, because one of the things when these guys first started with Limbs of the Arbitrator, they would get nervous and stuff, and I had to try to talk them down, like, dude,
I still get nervous.
These guys are here to see you.
Right.
I don't get stage fright at all, because
I still
these
get
people are here to... Dude, I bare my ass on stage to the crowd.
I don't get stage fright. I just...
You get nervous. That's what I'm saying. It's like, why?
No, I get stage fright.
We've rehearsed. We've done the work. Now we just have to go and play it. And we have to go show and perform. And these people are here. They paid money to see us play.
No, I'm kidding.
Why? Ding dong? But anyways, that had nothing to do with the cock magnet. All right, but anyways. So my question to you was, what is it that makes you nervous? Is it the performance in front of people? Is it, wow, I really admire this band Archspire that I'm going to be opening for.
Right.
That's what makes you like, these people are going to hear me play. They're my heroes. I look up to them. Is it that? Is it just,
man, are people gonna like us?
You know,
that kind of thing.
I think it has nothing to do psychologically. Like, when I go on stage, I'm not afraid of the crowd or anything like that. There's no gut feeling where I'm just like, oh, I'm gonna be afraid of them. I guess it's just me wanting to give them the best I possibly can and overthinking it.
Right.
Like,
no, I took. Is that a third beer?
Yeah.
Are you driving home?
Three more, and I'm not.
Three is pulling this from. Like,
three beers.
Do you just have like a portal that you're pulling this from?
He does.
And I've got cashews too.
I'm just guessing, a lunch bag.
I'm
just guessing that he knew that since the last tea time with Loda was over an hour. With you here,
he's like,
oh, fuck, this is gonna be a 2.5 hour.
Yeah, and I'm okay with that, honestly.
I can't go 2 hours
well,
without eating.
The thing is, though, is the average Sammy eats like every, I don't know, 20 to 30 minutes. So when he doesn't eat after an hour, shit starts getting real. Like,
you know, he's he's got to keep those jiggly tits. This is like his jiggly tit workout, right?
Yeah, exactly.
he's like, do you need a bucket? Are you gonna puke?
That's a waste of food.
Yeah, right?
He's like, who do you think I am?
He can't talk right now because his mouth is
completely full. I once saw Sammy throw up an entire fucking wine
completely
pizza
full of red velvet ding dong.
Yeah.
They're not ding dongs. Just
dong dings?
Dude, you pace yourself. They might be here for a little while longer.
I've got cashews, I'm cool.
I've got nuts.
You'll see him pull off cashews in 3 minutes.
I couldn't help it.
That was my next move.
Alright, okay, so let's get back. Sorry, let's rein this in again. We're in high school now.
Yes, high school.
Were you in any bands? We are progressing so slow, but I don't give a shit. I love this dude, and I'm having an amazing time talking to him.
Yeah.
Alright, so you were in bands in high school. What was your first band?
The first band I was in was called Amongst the Dead. Like, we were... Like, we just wanted to be trivium, basically.
Among the Fallen.
It was, my buddy Richard Campo,
Sorry.
Where's his face, huh? I'll be back here next time.
Richard Campo.
Yeah, he lived right next door to me, basically, like, just down the street, and, he actually introduced me to trivium, and he was just like, dude, check out this, like, awesome band, and, like, that was when I started, like, getting, like, in, like, leading and stuff like that, where I wanted to, like, start doing solos and stuff, and, like, that band, we eventually got a drummer, like, to play with us and stuff like that. And, I mean, it was just your basic, like high school band, like, trying to, like, get somewhere. This was freshman year for me, I think. I think this is, like, I must have been, like, 15 at the time. And, yeah, like, that was, like, my first band. And then I joined...
Cover songs, or were you,
It was original material.
Okay.
Yeah, but it was, like, super inspired off of Trivium. Like, we almost, like... bit them, like, so it was so bad, like,
yeah, that was gonna be my question.
Yeah,
it wasn't covers, but it was as close to covers as you could get, because you were basically borrowing
which
riffs.
I think when you're a starting out musician, that's totally fine, like, you look at your inspirations, I mean, you're not gonna make any money off of the songs you're writing,
right.
Like, who gives a shit? So, yeah, that eventually, I got good enough that I had, hit up Brendan Ball from Beyond the Pit. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that name, but,
and I know Brendan.
That's Brian's brother.
Yeah, Brian, Caleb Flint, and Ryan Morrison, and Greg Lewis. Greg Lewis is an awesome drummer, so.
Caleb Flint.
Yeah, and that band really pushed me musically. Like, that band,
so
like,
you were in Beyond the Pit?
I was in Beyond the Pit for, like, a year, and, yeah, that band kicked my ass to work on mechanics.
Yeah, a minute and a half.
Like, cause,
what'd I tell you?
Dude, I'm so hungry.
Brendan Ball was
so
such
sorry.
A good guitar player, like, for being 15 and just, like, shredding, like Steve Vai shit,
mm-hmm.
And not only that, but he was like super creative, wrote all his own material and stuff like that. But the thing about Beyond the Pit is like they envisioned themselves with only one guitar player. They were like a Rage Against the Machine kind of inspired band.
So what did they want you to do?
So no, like eventually they're just like we only saw the band as one guitar player, like, and I'm like okay, like, and then we parted ways after that.
But no animosity was
completely... no animosity. Like, I love all those dudes today. They're still like my homies.
Great musicians.
Nuts. Yeah, no, thank you.
Dude, he doesn't want your fucking nuts.
He just wants
the cock.
I want his, though.
Nuts.
Okay, so
yeah.
After Beyond the Pit. Wait, first of all, what is Brendan's brother's name?
Brian Ball.
He works at Guitar Center.
He does work at Guitar
Drummer?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Drummer. He's super good.
He's so
I'm
good.
So sorry, Brian. I forgot your name. Brian went on tour with Alice Chris.
He used to play for her. She has a fashion vice.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
A couple of...
couple of
summers. I have something to say about that when you're done.
I'm spitting out cash in a minute. A couple of summers, 2007, 2008,
right.
House Curse went on tour for like 3 weeks to the Midwest and back. And one of those, Brian Ball was my drum tech.
Right.
While we went out there, he came out there with us, set up my drums, tore them down, and that kind of thing. So. Good guy.
Yeah, super good guy.
The,
I love Brian.
Family's phenomenal. He's such.
And he is a really good drummer too. So
yeah.
I'm so sorry I forgot your name, dude. I feel like a fuck. Anyways,
like a
after
fuck.
Be on the pit. After be on the pit.
No, wait.
She has a passion for us. When I was like 19 years old.
Oh man.
Me and my friend Gerald started a band called Deception, and it was just me and him. And we were going through other guitar players, bass players, vocalists, and like nobody was serious enough. So we hear this band jamming in the same storage unit place. And we hear him playing, and they were fucking good. And we go down the way, and their door's wide open, and they're just, like, fucking dicking around before practice. They're waiting on their singer to get there. And, she has Fash Fast. We were, like, I don't know, 6 units away from them. And one day, they just, like, we talked to them for months. And we'd go there, hang out, drink beers with them and stuff. And then one day, they just disappeared.
Yeah.
And I was like, maybe they made it. Like, I don't know. Like, maybe they're on tour. But they just disappeared, and I hadn't heard anything until just now.
That's happened with quite a few Reno bands that like got really super popular. Wayward, are they still around?
No, they're not a band anymore.
Also,
that
another,
band,
they were
yeah,
funny story.
They were great.
I played a Battle of the Bands in Reno, and Wayward won the Battle of the Bands.
I can see that.
Yeah.
They were great. But like, yeah, we were, I think I was like 17 when we did that one.
There was like a hint of bitterness in his tone. I mean, and Wayward won, and I mean, they were great, but I mean.
No, they were good.
Like,
they were really good. Fucking good.
Yeah. Fashion Vice is a super sad story. Like, what happened? Like,
mm-hmm.
did you guys hear that they, like, almost got signed to Rise Records?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, like, apparently, like, they were waiting for, like, the representatives for Rise Records to come and meet them. And, like, they're all there sitting in the waiting room for whatever. And, like, an hour goes by, and, like, apparently the vocalist, like, decides he wants to do cocaine beforehand.
Oh, God.
And so, vocalist does cocaine, and, like, the guys at Rise Records, it takes them 5 minutes before, like, you know, you guys are unprofessional, and...
Wow.
And, like,
wow.
Rise Records is huge!
Yeah.
It's massive! You can get signed to Rise Records, you have a career. Like...
Yeah, pretty much.
If that were to ever happen to us, like, we got a meeting with Rise Records tomorrow, I'll be like, what time is it? 3? I'm going to bed at 5.
Yeah.
I'm going to wake up at 6, I'm going to have a cup of coffee.
But, you know, like, that's only the story I've heard from, like, various people. Like, I've heard it from one of the members, but I don't know if that's, like, the legit case, but that's what I just more or less heard.
Tea time with LOTA, spreading rumors.
Yeah.
Since 87.
Rumor time with LOTA.
No, that is
I've
a
been
bummer.
Spreading rumors.
Like I don't get that. Like, House Curse, one of the tours we did, we were in Salt Lake City, and we didn't have a show, but we had heard about a festival, and we're like, we got there. There were 2 stages, indoor and outdoor, and we're like, hey, do you guys have any room? We're on tour right now. We don't have a place to play tonight. And they're like, funny thing, we had someone drop off. You guys can play. No. Snot was the biggest band on that bill.
Right.
And so they were playing. One of the bands that saw us, like, we were like the third band to play that day. So not a lot of people were there yet. But the people that were there were just like, holy shit, why are you guys playing third? You guys should be way later. And
right.
I'm like, well, you know, paying our dues, whatever.
Right.
One of the bands that played later was like, oh, dude, Snot's in the back, man, they're doing cocaine, you guys want to come? All of us were like, fuck that. No,
yeah.
we're on tour. We don't want to kill ourselves. We want to play.
We
want to play music, and that's what it was about. And I don't. To each their own. I'm not coming down on people who want to do that. That's their own choice.
It just makes it hard for the stereotype of the fucking rock star.
You're
Well,
there's that.
Yeah.
But think about fucking career.
Well,
you know,
yeah.
There are certain bands. What was it, Gypsy Hawk? There's certain bands that can get away with playing drunk every night. Because they're just stupid good, but why would you want to risk that? I've been in bands.
Made their name doing that.
That's what the after party's for, anyways.
Right.
Exactly.
Like, but cocaine, heroin off a hooker's ass.
I was actually talking.
Well,
to
heroin is.
Heroin off a hooker's ass.
Cocaine off
a hooker's
ass.
That's what.
This is how many drugs I do.
I was talking to my friend today, Megan. I was talking to Megan today about how if we were to go on tour, I couldn't drink. I can't handle going and playing every single night and then waking up the next day hungover as shit with a headache, and then going and doing it all over. Like, my body's not built for that.
Dude,
I'd
I'm
have
not
to stop drinking completely.
I've been on
They'd be like, oh, we got 2 days off. I'd be like, yeah, I'm going to go crazy because I got the day off tomorrow. But then the day after that, nope. Like, I can't
go totally
hungover
like,
all the time.
I'm such a lightweight. Like, I remember I was drinking with my buddy Matt, who's in Transient Don, bass player. And,
amazing.
Beyond amazing.
We got, like, we were just like, oh, dude, I'm gonna get drunk tonight. Like, both of us. And so we got a bottle of tequila and a bottle of, like, whiskey. And so, like, one shot of tequila in, and I'm already
all of us are like, oh. Like,
you guys not like tequila? Oh.
No, I'm not saying, maybe it's not that they don't like it, it's just they already know what the after, they know where the store is heading.
Well, so, like, I take one shot, and I already feel the shit, because I'm such a lightweight, and then, like, I probably had five that night, like, I probably had five, so I was, like, pretty messed up.
Pretty good, yeah.
I
drink a lot, and five will do.
Well, they were half shots, so.
Five shots of tequila, I'm fucking done.
So two and a half. Shots is basically
probably two and a half, and so I was done after that, and I'm such a lightweight. I I can hold my alcohol. That's the weird thing. Like I'm lightweight, but I can hold it.
You know your limit is what it is.
Yep.
Yeah,
that's
I've never thrown up ever or blacked out ever.
Every time I'm going on tour with IDK with House Curse and all that, guess who was the driver after the shows?
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, with this band, if we ever go out for a week or 2 weeks or
we're
whatever,
switching
I'm not going to be the sober driver every fucking night after the shows.
I'll be the designated drunk, but
no. I'm not going to, and I'm not going to drink. I just, I don't drink, but, well, fruity drinks. But I'm not going to drink.
I'll buy you
drinks,
bro.
Yes, can I have a mimosa? Thank you.
Like, what do you want? Anything other than PBR? You want a Mike's Hard Lemonade?
Yeah, exactly.
I'm feeling a little bit parched.
Can I have a Smirnoff Strawberry?
An Angry Orchard?
An Angry Orchard. Yeah.
Okay, so, Beyond the Pit.
Yeah, Beyond the Pit.
After that,
I started doing my own solo stuff. It was my first solo project called Phoebe's Fountain. And
that's awesome.
Can I just tell me you got a
few
friends?
Wow.
Yeah.
Phoebe's from Friends? Phoebe from Friends?
No.
Disappointment.
I don't know where I got the inspiration for a name. I think I was watching a movie or something, and
you're
just like, I
watching
really...
Friends, Charlie.
You might have had a couple shots of tequila and just didn't remember that that's...
Like, my imagination was just going wild or something, so I was like, Phoebe's Fountain's the name. And then I started making my own tunes. They were horrible. They were like... Like, it was, like, wannabe, like, goth instrumental, like, it's like, super industrial.
My
inspired.
Wife probably would like it,
but like...
Yeah, I might like it, fucking hits me.
Yeah,
the music was so representative of, like, a girlfriend I broke up with, like, not that long after. So, like, all the songs were, like, extremely emo as
so
well.
You broke up with her after you wrote these songs?
Yes.
So were these songs for
her? No, they weren't for her. It was like angst about being with her and like stuff like that.
Angst about being with her. Do you hear me, Kristen? Fuck you.
Why am I still with you?
But that's
I hate you.
Exactly. And so I started doing vocals around that time as well. Like I like the guitar wasn't like really complex for that project. And like I started doing vocals and that got me introduced to stuff like that. And then eventually I was just like, fuck, this isn't working out. I'm not going to do that. And so that tanks.
Do you have recordings of this?
I they were on MySpace, but I deleted them a long time ago.
Son of a bitch.
I know.
They're out there somewhere.
They're probably out there in the data fields of MySpace.
Someone took an audio snapshot.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm still logged into my MySpace.
He's logged on MySpace right now.
But that turned into what became me doing vocals, and I really honed in on vocals for like 2 or 3 years.
Put the guitar down, or still doing the guitar?
I actually put the guitar down.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm fucking sure. Fuck you.
And I joined. I met up with Todd from Bridge the Divide, who's now the drummer for Tranky Don. So I meet up with him. And I actually was talking to him over StarCraft. We were both playing StarCraft, and I was just like, hey, dude, how's music going? And stuff like that. And he's just like, yeah, we can't find a vocalist. And I'm like, oh, well, I do vocals. And he's like, can I hear them? And so I sent him a cover of a Black Dahlia Murder song that I do.
So screaming, not
yeah, screaming.
Okay.
I'll scream. I can't sing for shit. But so, like, I sent him my Black Dahlia Murder cover, and he's just like, dude, this is really good. So I jammed with them, and then Bridge the Divide, I was just all vocals for like 2 years.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Raising my hand.
Do you think that it, maybe if you drink some bleach, like Danny Filth, you'd be
gargle
able to?
Gargle with it. I think gargling with it is probably safe.
None of those are going to gargle some bleach before.
Is that good to go?
Yeah, I'm saying, maybe if you gargle some bleach, you might be able to get that.
You know, it's a weird thing. Like, I can kind of do that Danny Filth howl for like four times, and then I can't do it anymore.
You have to add your voice.
Like, my buddy Andrew Zink, who lives in Florida, who's going to do some user lift stuff with me, he, same story. He's like, I can do those howls like four times, and then your voice is shot. Like, and
how does Danny do it?
Because he's inhuman. Yeah.
Tune in next week where we'll have Danny on the show.
Be like, you guys are just a bunch of fucking cunts.
Yeah, exactly.
That's all he says.
Yeah.
That's going to be his next shirt. It's going to be LOTA is a cunt.
LOTA is a cunt.
Well, it'll still be an honor.
Yeah.
He's wearing a LOTA shirt.
He's wearing a Cradle of Filth shirt.
Cradle of Filth press is still press.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so anyways, you're singing with your buddy Todd. What was the name of the band again?
It was Bridge of the Divide.
Bridge of the Divide.
And we had Jimmy Vesely, Aaron Hall, John Daniels, and Todd Morgan, and then me on vocals. And eventually that band tanks, like, members weren't getting along and stuff like that, so whatever. And then we turned it into Transient Dom, where I'm just like, okay, I'm going to pick up guitar again.
So what year are we talking?
We're talking 2 years ago.
Okay.
So 2 years ago, I pick up guitar, and I'm completely rubbish. I can't play anything.
2 years ago?
Like,
did you guys believe that?
Dude, you did that in 2 years?
2 years? I've only been taking guitar seriously for a year and a half.
Fuck
basically.
My life.
It was in...
Yeah, but this is the thing. Okay, but...
Quit!
This is a bunch of bullshit.
I'm not even a musician.
Okay, but this is the thing. No, he still had the foundation.
Damn. Yeah, yeah, I had to play
Trivium riffs. You still have a foundation of metal.
Right.
Kind of thing. Now, he did come a long way from writing those kind of riffs to what he's at now, but still.
Wow. I've been playing
How many hours
a
day were you practicing?
When we were getting really serious, because, like, I saw, like, huge, huge fucking potential for Transient Dawn, I was just like, I am going to just nonstop practice. I actually eat and slept and breathed music. Like, it was just...
way to do it, man.
Yeah.
It wasn't about getting pussy anymore.
No. That's far beyond. That was like...
When did the switch take place?
It was in Beyond the Pit, actually. Okay. Like, because I just saw how serious all the dudes were. Like, that they were formally trained and stuff like that. And I was just like, I really need to get my ass in gear. Because, like, all these guys have their asses in gear. Mm-hmm. And I just needed to... I strived to, you know, really get serious about music. So, but the skill didn't quite hit then. Like, I was just like, you know, still doing Trivium riffs. So then when Transient Dawn happened, like, I really got into, like, you know, making stuff that was, like, interesting and complex and, like, trying to, like, because I listen to a lot of music. I listen to a fuck ton of music. And I know, look at you.
Yeah.
And I
know those feels.
I was just trying to, like, look for stuff that, like shit that people haven't done yet, and that is incredibly hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So especially how saturated metal is, it's so fucking hard to find stuff, like...
And there's old one of the scriptures in the Bible, there's nothing new under the sun. And
right.
Music, it's almost... You've got 12 notes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've got a limited amount of scales and a limited amount of chords, and, okay, create something new.
Which is where I got into, like, doing more, like, stuff that was involved in different sonic territory. Like, because, like, you can't really make new scales and chords these days. Like, it's all been fucking done.
Mm-hmm.
Like, with westernized music, it just theory's been figured out, basically.
Yeah.
Like, it's just a matter of whether you know it or not.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to learning theory from the Rings of Saturn guitar player. And,
so he's pro theory.
Yeah,
he's saying you need to learn.
He's, like, Super Saiyan theory. Like,
okay.
So...
Holy crap, that was I just pictured like a whole fucking booklet of music just like growing super long blonde hair.
Like, his guitar pro icon on his desktop literally has like golden hair on it as
That's
well.
Amazing.
Like,
shaggy and he's like
So like I learned the theory and now I can like really put rules to what I'm doing and stuff like that. Like I'm not really like doing things that are out of context or things that are just more relatable with the theory side of things. And so I like more to like explore tones and stuff like that, like guitar tones. Like, and what can I, like, is I really love like atmospheric stuff, like post-rock sort of stuff. Like I'm super inspired by like Hammock, like is like a huge band for me. And I was just like, you know, they build so much massive atmosphere and so much like emotion, like in like these extremely reverberous rooms where you can just put yourself in that setting and, like, you know exactly what the music's trying to convey because of it. And I was thinking, what can I do to, like make, like, metal, like, more atmospheric? And so, like, I developed this, like spacey guitar tone that, like, really changed the way I, like, wrote everything. Because I could do those, post-rock, like guitar leads where it's just extremely reverberous, like super like speed picks, like 16 note triplets, and have it just echo like all around in a reverberous setting. And I could do that with metal. And then, like, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the band Fallujah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Flush Prevails comes out. And
incredible.
They do something extremely similar to what I was going for.
Like, son of a bitch.
Well, it wasn't so much that, because, like, I could still put my own spin on it. It was, like, unreached territory. So
quick technical question. Are you getting this atmospheric tone? You said you came up with
right.
a different tone. Through your pedals, through your head, through
I was going
your guitar.
I have a Pod HD 500, so it's like a pedal board that is like all one unit. And I got the inspiration for getting this thing because I saw this YouTube page called Fortiori. He does like recording tips and all that, and he was building guitar tones and like rhythm tones. I was like, man, you can do so much with this
thing.
Is
he that Irish dude?
No, he's not Irish. He's, I want to say he's from Germany.
Oh, close.
But he's doing so much shit with just this one little pedal board. And so I go and I buy one. I get one off of eBay for $300. Best $300 I've ever spent. And I buy it, and then I start going through all the presets. And then it has this, like, pitch-shifted preset that is on there where I'm just like, oh, like, I'm playing notes that are, like, super low, but it's coming up super high on my sound. And then I go into, like, I had reverb on it and, like, some, like, ping-pong delay on it as well. And it's just like, man, this tone is like super unique, and I was like super proud of it. And like, it's been on everything that I've written since.
You know, I think that's like one of the hardest things about being a guitar player is like finding like the perfect tone for your guitar that you absolutely like. I'm still working on it. Like, I've been through like 3 or 4 pedals now, and like I like all of them, but I don't like love all of them.
Yeah.
I think Dave's pedal, when he let me borrow, that's my favorite so far because it has like a noise suppressor built in already. You don't
right.
have to worry about another pedal. Like lugging that around, so like I really want to get that one, but I could sit there for like 3.5 hours just messing with like the tiniest like tweaks on the knob just forever.
Well, you know,
like,
the thing is, you'll never be happy. Like, you're
right.
always looking for better tone. I think it's a curse.
Like, can I just
like,
be like as good and just sound like Dimebag?
It's funny because like I always, every time I play, like whenever we practice and I'm hearing myself and I'm like, that's a good tone, I like it, I think that's cool. But I kind of want to add this to it, and I want to do that, and I wonder if I could do this, and I should take this home, and I should mess with it. And then Dave hears it, and he's just like, oh,
dude.
That, oh, that right there, oh my god, that's perfect, how did you get that? And I'm like, I have no idea, dude, I have no idea what I'm messing with. All I know is I moved a couple knobs, and then I played it, and everybody was like, that sounds awesome, and I was like, I'll do that then, because it
sounds
cool to me, too.
The worst part about building tones is worrying that you're going to fuck up what you already have. Like,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. When he finally got his tone where we were happy with it as a band, I took a picture and it's still on my phone.
Right.
Because
yeah,
it's like, oh, if something gets fucked up, it's like,
this is where I had it.
I'm
right
still
here.
Working on that. Something that is just the worst is when you come up with a sound that you really, really like and then you bring it to practice and somebody. No, I'm kidding. Sammy does this all the time, but he's got a lot of good, like, I don't know, advice for like sound. I'll be like, oh, I really love this sound. And then, like, we'll play as a band and I'm like, no, there's way too much trouble to compare to Dave's. It just sounds like.
That's the thing,
like,
with tone.
Yeah, we did that.
When you're
did
in a
that
band
at a
with
show
two guitar players.
I did it, like, I sat there and customized the sound on my buddy's pedal board,
right.
And he was like, yeah, is that the sound you want? I was like, yeah, and I was really stoked about it. And then you get mic'd up to a live show, and then I come out, you know, the second or third song in, and then I hear Dave hit an open, and then I hit an open, and I'm like, oh, and I can't do
one's
it.
One's all throaty, and one's
yeah,
all
it
like
doesn't match up as a band,
yeah.
And it's like,
yeah. That's one of the things I was going
to
say.
But you think you have a great sound, and then you match it to the rest of your band, and you sound like eh.
That's totally accurate. I actually have two different, like, set patches for me. Like, I have my recording patches that I use, like, exclusively for recording. But, like, if I turn that shit up, like, on my amp, it does not sound good. It sounds, like, too trebly. It sounds, like, way too much screech in your ears.
That has a big effect, like, when you turn up, like,
yeah,
for practice or a show. It's
adding
like,
volume
is
gained into the microphone and all that stuff.
Yeah,
it's
way worse.
And so,
I'm waiting for the day I'm gonna be really embarrassed when I go to play a show and the fucking sound guy's like, can you turn down the gain on that motherfucker? God damn. I'm like, sorry.
I mean, I can, but you're
sorry.
Yeah.
I thought I was professional.
Yeah, I thought I knew what I was doing. I'll go home now.
But dude, we're having to mess with that here because live, like the last 2 shows we played, somebody's amp on stage was setting off my kick trigger.
We have no idea whose it is.
Like, too much low end?
Don't know. I
started.
Wow.
It's
I
when
started
we play individually, it works fine. And then we play as a band and it starts.
The first couple shows that I, because I have a Roland TM2.
Right.
And so it's only got the two. I've got my 808 hooked up to it and I've got my kit hooked up.
comes up. Right. Everything else, I like dynamic. I don't like, you know, I just want
right.
my kick.
Exactly.
I do a lot of shit on my kick. I want it to be heard. So that's why I got this. And the first show we played went off without a hitch.
Okay.
Nobody was setting the trigger off, and I didn't adjust anything. I left the pitch. I left the...
Where were you playing when it set off your kick?
At Jump Jumps.
At Jump Jumps.
With Josh's sound system, which is now PB&J's.
Jump Jumps has notoriously huge low end. In
those
that,
subs underneath
those
the stage.
Subs
yeah.
underneath the stage. I'm guessing it was probably that. Like,
but it didn't set it off
last
the first
time,
time.
Last time
when you were at Jump Jumps the
first
time?
First time we played at Jump Jumps, it didn't went with... The screamo band that was
going
back.
Oh wait,
no. That's what
show?
I was gonna say. We played for Everybody Dies in Utah, and it was the other band.
Was
I think
there.
It was. Damn it, it was the Skinwalkers.
Trophy Wives.
Oh my god, there is the one guy who was just like, "Are you fucking kidding me?
Dude.
Like, why don't you do that?" And I was just looking at him like, seriously? Like, shut the fuck up, man. I was
actually,
like, you're like 17 years old. I'd have slapped you in the neck.
I actually had, like, I'd be excited if you went to that, because Lions, the band that played with you that night, I'm, like, super good buddies with their singer.
Right,
like,
because he's from Reno, right?
Yeah, he's from Reno. I've known him since I was, like, 8. I was talking to him about it. He's like, dude, he just had a spit. Like, he's been, like, crazy nice all tour. Like, he was like, just for like 30 seconds, he just like lost his shit. Like,
yeah. He was super nice to us.
Like,
wasn't
he like complaining because there was too much like
low end?
Yeah, he was like, this rumbling, what am I supposed to do? And I'm like, that's what subwoofers are for. Like, I'm just looking at him like,
that's like, that'd be like,
I didn't know how to react. I just wanted to pull him down and fucking punch him in the face. I was like, dude, you're being an absolute cunt right now.
Everyone in that audience was just like jaw dropped, like, holy fuck, you're an asshole. Like,
yeah.
Like,
I didn't even see that.
But yeah,
just,
I mean, well, that's just a snapshot.
You should
and
be happy.
Everything else was perfect.
God.
It's like, dude, but that's all it takes is one negative thing to turn everyone's opinion.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
it's a bummer.
That show was actually, was that, you were at that show?
I was at that show, yeah.
I think it was the Spring Meltdown show we played. By far my personal worst experience with the show, just because of my, there was
the cord
that was
all
somewhere.
Fucked up.
And I was like, I saw you guys play, and I was like, okay, so we can't follow that, so.
But we had to follow that.
Yeah, but when we started playing, everything was fine. We did soundtrack, everything was great, and then we start playing, and I do friggin' dun-dun, dun-dun, and then, like, the third one, just nothing. And I was like, what is that? So I played the entire set, not being heard, except for the chord would cut in and out randomly, and when... we had all of our sound. We were sounding really good. I was playing better than almost any show I've ever played in my life, but you couldn't hear me.
That's
even
so
if that happened at Cargo, too. Like, it started to cut in and out, and
well,
I was like, fuck, like, I'm not trying to fix you.
That was my battery dying for the thing, because I didn't think to bring, or I couldn't bring the cord because it just broke.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, I'll just put a new battery in there, and I probably put an old one in there, and then it started cutting out, and I was like, fuck, and then I, like...
And then I messed up, and then I hope we get that, because he yelled at me, and I'm like, I know you can hear that in the background. Dude! And I'm all, fuck, I'm sorry, like, his pedal distracted me, I was trying to fix his shit for him.
Whatever. So the lesson here is carry spare, if you're a guitar player, carry spare batteries, 9 volts, and have a backup cord.
At all times.
All
right. What is it with cords that is just so shitty?
It's because you think you have everything you need, and then you show up and you're like, fuck, I forgot this important part of my equipment. It's
I swear to God, I have 30 cords that don't work, but one that barely works.
Get rid of those.
I spent $80 on cords, and I guarantee you, I played 2 shows with them, I guarantee you one's going to go out.
Yeah.
By like
it's amazing how unreliable
like, really?
Cords are.
If you guys
practice
playing,
once a week and then a show once a month, cords are assholes.
If you guys play at BB&J's, beware, I would bring your own power strips. Because, like, they have outlets in the front of the stage for, like, all the guitar players and stuff like that, whatever you're going to plug in. But they're concaved, so, like, the floor starts here, but the outlets are down here.
Oh,
like,
shit. Oh, what the fuck?
Yeah, so, like, I'm trying to plug in my pod, like, into it.
No,
and
that
like,
does
ugh.
Not work.
So bring your own power strip so you can have it up and out.
I think
Dan
usually brings one to every show.
Yeah. Okay, but
that's
you need
one.
To.
Yeah.
Take it easy.
No, okay, so the Spring Meltdown is where these guys were setting off my trigger.
Right.
And then, but then I played a set with IDK right after. Like, I had to switch the
Arbitrator
bass drum head to IDK on. And those guys weren't setting my trigger off at all.
So there's something about our sound.
So there's something about one of the tones was either, I was thinking it was maybe the frequency, was just
well, it was weird
vibrating
because that was
my bass drum head. Just
that was the first time that, like, I had switched sides. Because I normally, like, we've played at Jub Jub's. We played on that stage, and I played, like, on
stage,
yeah.
He's played stage
and then
right.
I played stage right, and it was just setting, and then, but when we practice, it's not me, it's like Dave.
It's like Dave.
Hitting off a low F or a C will do that,
something.
Like, super vibrating tones, like.
So I tweaked everything, and not only that, I put, now I've got two triggers on my kick, one on each side, so depending on what side I'm getting overloaded with the bass and a guitar cab. I'll put the trigger in on that side.
Right, right.
On the opposite side. So if I've got two guys over here, then I'll put the trigger over here.
Do you use
both
two kickheads or one kickhead?
What do you mean?
Kick drums, sorry.
One.
Drums.
I just
one.
Okay, good. Yeah, because Todd actually, he was using two kick drums just for the sake of, like, trying to, like,
like
not set off his triggers, like, because you know how, like, if you're using one kick drum, you'll accidentally set off a trigger, like, it'll misfire or something like that.
Yeah.
So I got two kick drums just to, like, cure that. I don't know how it's working out for him. I haven't really talked to him about
it. My left foot, I've always had this problem, and I can hear it on some of the recordings. I've had to, like, be there when the engineer was, you know, not fixing my shit, but getting it ready so that the guitars can come in and lay their tracks.
Right.
And I'd be like, dude, my left foot, a little lazy. And
yeah.
So I'll prep it. Like, if I'm going to do some fast-paced
right.
stuff, my left foot will go down and kind of push off before I lift it up, and it hits the head. And so you hear this little flam right before...
I don't know anything about, like, drumming or anything like that. Like, when you're setting up your pedals, like, do you adjust the beater head for each, like, foot that you do? Like
the tension will be a little bit different.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
Just because mostly because my dominant foot... is like, you know,
right.
But then the other one, it's not quite so. Plus, you're the slave pedal. I'm not racist. The slave pedal, that's what it's called. The slave is off of a you know,
right.
The beam or whatever, and so you're having to do a little more work with this one, and so yeah, you'll adjust that a little bit. But
okay.
The head, the beaters themselves, actually, the one is a little bit farther back too.
Okay.
So it's having to try
to try compensate for
right
it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So you have to figure out all that shit, but it's my own lazy playing and my technique is what sometimes when I'm prepping pushes the bass drum head just a little bit.
Right.
You get that extra noise that you have to go and fix. Or it'll set off the trigger a little bit. That I could deal with in a live situation. In the studio, it bugs the shit out of me. And then when my bass player or my guitar player is all of a sudden setting off, it's not you, but your amp is setting off the trigger for no
reason.
It's not
you, but it's you.
It's not you, but it's your stuff. But yeah, when that's setting off my trigger, I'm just like, fuck, this sucks, man. Because it sounded so great the first show we played.
Right.
I'm like, this is what I needed. I've been waiting for this. And the 808, dude.
Oh, yeah.
I'm so happy to have that thing. I've wanted that for a while. But every once in a while, when you hear that trigger get set off by someone that's not me, and
yeah.
it's out of your control, it's
yeah.
like I've tried to get it adjusted, and I think I've got it now. To where it's
dealing
like
with stuff that is out of your control is the most frustrating thing ever. Like when we played at PB&J's, like my amp and everything on my gear was fine. What was wrong was they mic'd on my cab, but like the monitors in front of us, like the monitors, your stage monitors, so you can hear yourself, kept cutting out. I couldn't hear myself all night. Like
that's
I had,
not on you. It's like. Yeah. Then you come off like a prima donna if you're like, oh, dude.
Well, no, I just went with it. Like, I knew my parts well enough that I didn't have to, you know, worry too much about it. I still relied on my cab and my Mesa 4x12, which more than gets the job done.
Right.
Like, I was able to rely on that. But it was, you know, it was distracting because the
totally.
Sound of the monitors is coming out and your sound of the amp is, like, cut, like is solid. So it's just cutting out. And you're like I hope this doesn't mess me up later. But,
yeah.
Yeah, no.
And you're trying to put on a great performance, and you're getting agitated, and that's kind of showing, and you don't want it to show,
and
you want people to enjoy it.
Sometimes,
right.
Which has happened to me like a couple times. Like I fucked up one part, and I had to like completely stop for a second. Like I turned around, I was like, okay, there it is, and then like turn around, I was just like.
Sometimes these guys won't be able to hear each other on stage, like
yeah.
the two guitars, because they're opposite sides, and if the monitor guy doesn't know what he's doing, or we didn't get a good mix ahead of time, I'll be like, you know what, just focus on me. I know what I'm doing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Just
that's always
you know if you know my
yeah,
parts,
yeah.
learn my parts as well, because that way you can just catch up. With
most
me.
Time
the drummer leads,
the drum.
Like and
yeah.
the
most
music, the pace of the music, the drummer leads. So you just focus on them.
Yep.
Like,
exactly. So. Anyways, all right. Sorry about all that technical talk, and I know we're going long, but again, I hope you're enjoying this as much as we are. All right, so we're basically caught up. We're almost there. You've now started Transient Dawn.
Yes.
But it's just you and Todd.
It was me, Todd, and Tyrell, because Tyrell had joined Bridge of the Divide just before it, like, collapsed. So we just wanted to salvage Bridge of the Divide the best we could, so...
But knew you were going to go in a different direction, so...
Right.
Different band name.
So, like, so it's not me on vocals anymore. I pick up the guitar, and me and Ty start writing songs. Mm-hmm. And that turned into what's Transient Dawn's Day. We eventually got Matt.
You didn't answer the question how much... You said you were practicing a lot, but you didn't say how much you're practicing.
Like
8 hours a day, 6 hours a day?
It was...
Whenever you could?
It was, like, whenever I could, basically. Like, I...
But you'd make the time.
Well, I would make the time, because, like, right before that, before I was, like, taking guitar seriously, I was, like, raiding hardcore in World of Warcraft. So, like...
Gamer!
I would just be, like, fix my computer screen, blah, 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 but, like, as soon as I, like, it only took, like, a day for me to realize, fuck this, I have this. Mm-hmm. So I start taking guitar seriously immediately. And I just, it fell in love with it all over again. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, so, like, I build up all of the skill that I have today, basically, with Transient Dawn.
In 2 years.
Almost 2 years. In January, at least.
So it's not even 2 years. It's close to 2 years.
I'm locking myself in my room playing.
It's 2 years.
That's pretty much what
I know. Right? I gotta lock myself. I gotta do that. I gotta do bass. I gotta do drums.
Well,
out of all of us, Phil's probably the one that practices the most. That's all he does.
I practice, but not behind my kid.
I still feel like it's not.
Well, I mean, if it comes to, like, drumming and stuff, every day, if I'm driving, I'm practicing.
I'm up in Tahoe writing drum parts, rehearsing my drum parts, even while I'm delivering the mail. I'm constantly practicing, not behind my kid.
Like, my biggest thing right now is I'm trying to do everything I can to lead with my left foot, because my left foot is slower than my right foot. And if I do doubles, I can do fine, but then I'll start to hear it get off time. So I just build it up. That's all I do, is I just try to play, like, not super strong, like, quick, complex beats, but just, like, stuff that I used to start with, and I'll just start with my left foot now.
When I first got my double pedal back in college, you know, back in Stone Ages, before I even tried to do patterns with it, I would just sit there. Actually, before I even got my fucking pedal, I knew I was going to be getting a double pedal. And I would be at the, you know, we're all sitting in the lunch cafeteria, whatever.
Right.
And I'd be sitting there for 20 minutes eating my food, just nonstop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just trying to get it even, to get the same amount of pressure,
right.
So one's not, like, accidenting over the other one. And I would just do that. Even when I got the pedal, for, like, 3 months, I did not even set the pedal up, because I'm like, I'm not comfortable yet. I want to make sure I'm good to go. Once I got behind the kit with that pedal, it was, like, no work, because I already got to work outside, you know.
And so, I did all of my double pedal learning on the fly, like, and most of it, honestly, was with City of Evil, Avenged Sevenfold. And it just turned into this thing where, like, I would just put the album on repeat, and then whatever parts I could play, I would play along, and then... That's gonna be so, dude. That was the hardest thing ever. But once I figured out that I could do the album from front, like from just front to back, I was like, holy shit. And I would just play it all the time.
I still have to hear him do this, because I don't believe me.
I can't do that. Not even
the rap, his drumming on that album is so good.
It's unbelievable.
Anyways, okay.
I can't even do it on my hands.
So, Transient Dawn, you've got three of you, two guitars, one drummer.
And then
When does Matt come in?
Like 2 months later. So it was about March when we got
Matt. So you're still building songs, and so you're not necessarily in a hurry to get the bass player, but...
Well, we put our ad on Craigslist, but, like, the main focus was, like, building songs. And so Matt was actually the first person who hit us up on Craigslist.
Hmm.
Like, we had no prior bass player up until that point, so...
Had he been playing in other bands?
Yeah, he had mixed stuff in, like, and he was actually super into a band that he was in called Crossroad Heathens.
Hmm.
So he's in that band, and, like, he's, like, the leader of that band. And he's you know, pulling all the strings for them. And I actually had to convince him to stay in Transient Dawn.
Hmm.
Like, he was just like, no, I'm, like, super in love with it. You know, it's like, I put so much work into Crossroad Heathens and stuff like that. And I'm just like, dude, like, just give it, like, a couple weeks. Like, stay in with this. And then he's never looked back. Like, so.
That's awesome. Your guy's phenomenal.
Dude.
That is amazing. Like, I love that guy so much.
This just this morning when I showed him Dawn of Dimension, he was just like, how have I never heard this band? And
dude,
I was like,
so
right?
Like,
I was like, dude, and he's like, I can't do that. And I was like, you can absolutely do that. Like, I'll never be able to do that, but you can. Like,
he posted that video in band chat, like, right after you showed him. And, like, I'm just, like, looking at it, and he's, like, doing this weird tapping with
his hand. Yeah, right? He was doing it super strange. But, like, I think what got me was that he was doing sweeps he would do sweeps down with his thumb and then back up with like his middle finger. And I was like, how the fuck do you do that, dude?
Bass players
like,
are like
ridiculous.
Have spider hands. I don't know how they do it.
It freaks me out. I cannot watch them do their thing.
Right.
And they're having to press down harder than you pussy ass guitar players. So.
Yeah, exactly.
No, but I can't watch it without getting freaked out. Even some of the guitar players, like some of the chord stuff that Dave does, where he's placing his fingers, I'm like, dude, it freaks me out. It just
if you catch a chord like a really weird one in like the wrong position with your wrist, it fucking hurts. You're like you'll twist your elbow the wrong way and you're like ow.
But it's also your guitar, the main one you use live.
The Strandberg.
Yeah.
I think
that
it's
freaks
awesome.
Me out too.
That
the fretless.
So
it's not fretless.
No, it's not fretless.
No, it's fan frets.
Right.
Yeah. No, I love that.
But yeah, that guitar, it just I look at
that thing looks badass.
Yeah, no, it looks amazing, but I still look at it and I'm like, something's wrong
here. Yeah, it's got no headstock and it's fan frets.
Something's not right.
Yeah.
And then you hear him playing on it and you're like, yeah, something's definitely not right. Is it the power of is it the guitar with the power, or is it Charlie with the power, or is it a combination of them both?
The guitar is amazing. I actually have trouble not playing other Schramberg guitars now. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like...
Are you looking for a sponsor, endorsement?
See, that's the thing. It's like, I'm hoping, like, Ola Schramberg, the owner of Schramberg Guitars, like, will notice me eventually. Like, he sent me a friend request on Facebook the other day, and so I was just like, oh, senpai.
Almost there, dude.
So if I can get him to notice me and just, like, the thing with endorsements is, like, when you're endorsing an artist, you need to make sure that they have value, mm-hmm. that they can sell instruments,
right.
Like, because people want to look at it and be like, oh, well, that person plays a Strandberg, I want to play a Strandberg, mm-hmm. like, so that's the toughest thing about it, and...
They want to see how many hits your videos are getting, they want
right.
to see how often are you hitting the road, playing out to where people are going to be asking about the guitar.
Right.
Can they put like an ad on your merch table?
Right.
All that stuff.
That's the thing about it, because like I'm endorsed with Swiss Picks as well. And
which I thought we were gonna do. It's funny because I thought we were gonna do this like at your house today, and I know a while back you were like, "Yeah, I'll let you try them out and use it."
Oh,
and
yeah.
Super excited about it.
Do I have one in my pocket? Oh, I do.
You're endorsed by.
Oh, nice.
You're endorsed by.
I'm endorsed. They're super ripped. Like I'm sorry.
Oh no, that's okay.
Yeah.
Like.
Those are the ones I used. They're the 55mm.
Feels really good, though.
It's awesome. I've never even heard of these.
The grip? I mean, what is it about these?
They're extremely durable.
Do the holes allow for airflow when you're picking?
Well, I'd actually argue that it has less overall grip than, like, a Dunlop Tortex. But, like...
Yeah, because it's got that... It's
the
got
thing
that
about
feel.
A Dunlop Tortex is if you grip it wrong, you're stuck with it. Like...
Yeah.
Like, you can adjust your grip on this guy.
On the fly.
You
can
adjust
your
drop.
But it feels so good.
Like that, and it's extremely durable. Like the picks last for a long time. Where go ahead and you want to keep this?
Dude, I
have
a dude. He's endorsed. Are they heavy? Are they medium?
No, they're extremely light. Like I use 55s. Yeah. He actually custom made those for me, like the 55s. Like he had the model for him, but nobody buys 55s.
This is perfect, dude. There's give. But it's not too oh my god, for a bass player, this is...
Yeah,
for a bass player...
Sorry!
For a bass player...
I'm sorry! Look, I can do both. I can, okay?
Does Matt use a pick?
Matt will do both. Matt's a firm believer that there's techniques used for both.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because
and sound. Like, there might be a certain
tone,
sound you want to get
yeah.
for the pick.
Because, I mean, like, for free stuff, you might want to use a pick. Like, if you're, like, playing gently, super, like, you know...
Staccato.
Staccato notes. You're probably going to want a pick. But yeah, if you're playing tech death, you might want to use your fingers. It's like, but I mean,
which is,
there's exceptions for everything.
Like I like playing with a pick, and I've always been against it. Okay, I've been playing bass for like 13 years, and I should be way better, and I'm not. I suck. But like, I've been playing for a long time, and I've always been super against using a pick. But the shit that Dave plays, I cannot play with my fingers. I can't. I'm like, dude, it's so awkward.
You don't have spider hands.
Because Dave goes
yeah,
from like,
I don't...
the top string all the way to the fucking bottom string all the time.
And because I'm always trying to follow him and playing my own stuff on top of it, I'm just like, I can't do it. Like, I have to use a pick.
Now, here's a question. Felt picks. Do they give you... Have you ever heard of felt pick?
I have
on a bass.
Heard of it.
I'm
not.
On a... No.
Because I'm curious, because you don't have the scratchiness of a plastic pick. You would have a smoother, deeper tone, you would think.
Not necessarily, because it doesn't get the same treble out of it.
I guess if you're like playing jazz, that might be something that you're willing to go for. But if you're playing metal, you almost want that trebliness with your bass to like add the rumble.
That's a good point.
That's why I like this. That's why I freaked out, because I was like, this has that thickness. It's still thin enough to do whatever I need to do.
When I'm playing, I notice a lot of scratching. He could have handed you a rock, and because you would have been from him, you would have been like,
whatever.
Dude, that's perfect!
I can do this! Yeah, no, I love
like,
this.
Yeah, I just got that out of
the super excited
yard.
To go home and try this.
I'm sorry they're so, like, used. I think...
I don't know why you're...
No, I don't think he's... Dude, he's... I'm surprised he hasn't put it in his mouth yet, like...
I remember at that Inflame show, I caught Bjorn's pick from Inflames, I caught that thing, and I saved it for so long, and then I lost it. I don't know what happened to it.
Oh, I'm so upset.
I had a pick from Ted Nugent.
Oh, did you?
I saw Dan Yankees live back, you know, in the Stone Ages, and dude, I caught that, and lost it, like, almost immediately.
Oh,
I was so bummed out. I'm like, fucking the Nuge, man.
The Nuge. Yeah. Fez, they're supposed to say Ted. Yeah, that's what they said. No, they're supposed to say Ted. Yeah, Ted. Look, they say Ted Nugent.
All right, we need to wrap this up, I guess. I don't want to.
Yeah.
I don't want to. This is awesome.
Fun.
This is awesome. But and learning about you.
Thanks for coming down.
Yeah,
totally.
I didn't say we're wrapping it up like 30 seconds from now. But
well,
we need to kind of.
We were just thanking him for coming down.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Oh, just okay.
Jumping to conclusions.
My bad.
What's the matter? You fucking hate this, right?
I spent 2 hours.
Apparently, Jeremy's done.
No, I'm just saying for everyone. You know, this is so long. It's probably not going to be on the internet tonight. My computer is probably going to be like, oh, okay, this is going to take 2 days to upload.
It's just like you're getting out of control. That's all.
Right.
Is there a counter on it? Does it tell you how long we've been going for?
Yeah, an hour, 20 minutes.
Oh, that's not fucking bad. You got more time?
Yeah, I got more time.
Fabulous. I mean, we're
I mean, 2 hours and 20 minutes.
What, you said 2 hours, 20 minutes?
No, I'm kidding.
Yeah. I'm like, maybe I should break this up into two. I just don't have the technical prowess on a fucking iPhone to be able to do that shit.
Yeah.
But anyways. People,
I can stop
I just,
it.
I'm just worried that... The longer we go,
I do have an iPhone.
Yes! That's the only one that doesn't.
He's used to being in a minority.
He's a fag droid over here.
Oh, yeah. Did you hear what he said? He used to be in a minority.
No, fuck off. White people are a minority now, all right? We're in America.
Dude, you were like, as soon as he got here last night, who was it that said,
It was Devin. He was like, hey, the Mexican's here. And dude, I have never felt such an urge to
just
like, fucking hit someone. I was like,
kick your ass. The Mexican's here. It was so funny.
God, I'm not. Look, here's the thing. Okay, first of all, any other.
Tangent. Here we go.
Any other Hispanic, or Spanish speaking, like, person does not like being called Mexican if they're not. Especially if you're fucking Salvadorian, okay? We don't fucking like it, I'm sorry!
I have a question. What's worse, him calling you a Mexican last night, or Brian referring to you as Muslim?
But he can't grow a beard, he can't be Muslim.
So Brian's
okay,
an idiot.
So which one's worse?
Mexican. Easy.
Alright.
Yeah.
Okay, you don't see me running the streets going, so like, I don't.
We will tonight.
No, the last episode we saw you going like this.
Yeah. And welcome. I am Sammy in boots.
Okay, so Transient done. You're doing that. You've got your other side
It's actually the main focus. The user lives. And
have you recorded anything?
Which, if you haven't already paused this video to go look at how, because we've been praising him the entire time, and people are like, oh, well, nothing. Shut your face. Most of the stuff that he's posted is from the user lives, right?
Yes.
And all of it is just like...
Thank you, Sam.
Dude! Holy crap!
We'll give you whatever information we can, like, in the description of the YouTube video for his websites. Are you on, like, Sikitar or any of those other websites?
No, just theuserlives.com/face. Or for Facebook.com
slash
your
face. Facebook.com/your face. Wait, no.
Slash cock magnet.
Hashtag cock magnet.
Can we all just start a band?
I'm so
can all of us just start a band called cock magnet?
He
will quit in a heartbeat when he realizes how shitty at least I am. You're like, fuck this, I'm out.
You can dress you up as the cock magnet.
Let me get Ryan cock dress up like a dick. You guys just run from like you started.
No, it won't even be a dick. It'll just be an Ibanez starter pack.
And there's just fucking dick that's just stuck to it, like ah.
This is sheer brilliance.
So we've got dick knife murder stick.
Yeah.
We've got a machine built for war. We've got cock magnet.
Cock magnet.
I don't know what was the fucking record. What was the label that you wanted to start?
My label is Skill Set Entertainment.
Skill Set.
Yeah, that's not metal at all. Yeah,
we got the numbers. We got like 7 bands. One of them is bound to make it.
Oh yeah, absolutely,
exactly.
LOTA's on the rise.
That will carry the rest of
Machine
them.
Is yeah, fucking exactly. Running around like a chicken with its head cut off.
Dude, okay, so
well, actually, masturbating like chicken's like.
I don't know why I was trying to interrupt that. We just bought, Lindsay Arbitrator just bought a 32 channel Tascam
mixer, right?
Digital recorder.
Okay.
So we can like literally record onto this thing
and
bump it from there.
Right.
Yeah, we can get CD quality from this recorder.
Right.
That's awesome. Do you have any knowledge?
Well, my knowledge of recording from pre-pros, which like I'm very proud of my pre-pros. They sound very good.
Mm-hmm.
So
he knows.
I don't even have like a 32 channel mixer. What I have is like a single interface. It was $150. It's a Scarlett 2x2, and it has two inputs. It has two like a. What do you call them? Forgetting the quarter inch cable inputs. So what I do is I hook my pod through that, and then I record into a recording software called Cubase.
Cubase is pretty good.
And before that was Logic
Logic Pro.
Yeah, Logic Pro. Yeah, and then before that was GarageBand. Like my first experience with like recording on DAWs was GarageBand. So
I feel like when GarageBand hit, everybody kind of like all musicians sort of lost their minds for a minute.
Yeah,
we were like,
thing,
"Oh my God, GarageBand! Like
GarageBand
we can do
was
this
good
now."
For the music and stuff, but it was so limited with drums.
It was very limited with
and time signatures.
Like so, then I got Logic and the Logic stuff at the game, and then Cubase is like the easiest I've ever fucking worked with anything. So I have yet to work with Pro
isn't
Tools.
What Brian has is Cubase.
Was it?
Say Logic.
He has Logic.
Reason.
Was it Reason?
Like yes. No, he doesn't like Reason.
Reason.
Dave's the one that has Reason.
Yeah, Dave had Reason and wanted
Brian
to
had it. This, honestly, Brian had some program so I've never even heard of.
Okay.
Reason is really abstract. Like, Reason, the way Reason is set up is, like, no other DAW that I've ever seen. Like, you actually get, like physical representations of like your plugins and stuff inside of it. Like you can there's like a switch you can flip on Reason to see the back where all the chords are plugged in and shit. Like it's so weird.
And you set it up because how you customize it yourself, how you want it plugged in. It is very advanced. Reason is my favorite program by far.
Too convoluted for me personally. Like, cause like I'm just in the business of recording pre-pros for like who's gonna record my stuff professionally. So,
Tudick will.
Well, actually, the vocalist that I'm getting for the User Lives, he's like, he owns a studio and all that.
Is that your friend from Florida?
From Florida,
yeah.
And he's throwing vocals on that, which I'm so excited for. I'll show you guys once we're done recording the video here, like a snippet of it. But,
You guys don't get to see
it. You saw Sammy light up? He was like,
you guys don't get to
see it. Damn!
Okay, so Cubase, now using Cubase.
Yeah, Cubase is awesome. Like, and so like when it goes back to your 32 channel mixer thing, like that'll be really useful if you're gonna record live drums. But for me, like everything I do is through Superior Drummer, so like a program based drums.
Yeah.
So having all those inputs will be good for you.
The only problem is it's got 8 usable, eight physical, and 32 digital.
Okay,
so we would have to like my kit. I was doing the math, and I'd have to have at least 14 mics.
Right.
I got 8. So I would have to do a certain amount, and I'd like have to leave accents on my rototoms, like fills. I'd have to take that out. I'd have to take out maybe the chinas and just go in and punch those in.
It's the problem with recording drums is get as few mics as possible. Like that, for reasons, because like there's less mics to set up, and like less bleeding going on between the mics, which
yeah,
is a huge
exactly.
problem. If you're not an expert, you're fucking up, basically.
Right.
Like, so,
so much
what I would do is, are you planning on miking your kicks?
Yeah, but it's, I mean, we have the TM2, so, I mean, it's going to be triggered.
I would trigger, just do the triggers.
Well, yeah, that, but then, yeah. Yeah, exactly. We're gonna. Well, Dave did want to do a mic on that as well, but and every time I've been in the studio, he's done a mic on top and bottom of the snare.
Right.
I'm like, all right, well, let's just. We're, obviously, we're not gonna get that, so let's just go with the top.
Right.
And same thing with I-Hat. We do top and bottom for some
reason.
Right. I have no idea why. But no, I'm trying to see where I can cut corners. We have a five piece kit,
right.
Mic, and with two overheads, but. Like I said, man, there's just certain things that I'm not. I mean, like I've got three rack toms. I've got my Rota toms, three
right.
rack toms. I'm gonna have to take out my high rack because we just don't have the mic for it. And just trying to see how can I get it to eight.
There's a reason it's the hardest instrument to record. It's like so,
dude,
so hard.
The video, we got a DVD with this Tascam recorder, and he doesn't say anything about drums.
Oh.
Whatsoever. And I'm like, okay, so this is going to be trial and error, and that's the first thing that gets laid down.
You know what's good about that is you learn it for yourself.
And that's the thing, that's why we got this. Instead of, because we were talking about rehearsing these songs and getting them as tight as we could, going to a studio in SAC, or going to somebody in Reno, trying to do that, and Dave saw this recorder for $400 bucks. Dude, let's just get what we need and figure it out ourselves, because then we can record and put out, if we can learn it to get quality, we write a new song, we can put that out
exactly
whenever we want.
Have you ever heard of The Ongoing Concept?
I think I've heard that name.
So they're this band, and that was this
thing. They make their own instruments.
Yeah, dude.
I've heard of that band.
They made their own instruments and then recorded with their own, like, recorded everything on their own.
Right.
But, like, from scratch, made their own.
That's really ambition right there.
Wow.
That's too much vision.
The new album sounds...
You gotta really want it.
No, but it sounds incredible. The new album is so good.
That's awesome, but I'd rather just buy my...
No, but I'm just... like, I mentioned... No, because I mentioned it every time.
Right? Doesn't mean, like, I'm an actual lumberjack when I go down.
like, when you do stuff like Sammy's saying, you learn that skill for life. Like, you learned how to build your instrument. Now you can do it whenever you want. There's no such thing as putting too much effort into like anything, like, because like the more effort you put into something, the more you learn about it, and then you have skills built up for everything, especially with music.
Right.
Like I feel like I've got my hands into like every little thing. Like I'm not particularly focused on one thing. Mm-hmm. So like I know stuff about recording, promotion, writing, theory, all of this stuff. So like it helps me knowing that I'm well rounded. That if I ever need
get on out of here, cat.
He's allergic, so sorry.
If I ever need to like communicate ideas with somebody, I could tell them like stuff I know because I've dabbled in it, like at least. So I think being well rounded is like super important. Like, it's something people struggle with. It's just like I'm just gonna focus on guitar, like just gonna focus on writing riffs or something like that. But like you never learn to handle things on your own, like especially in Reno where there's not like a lot of good studios.
Right.
Like
there's a couple. Decent ones.
But. Right, but like knowing how to record yourself is so important, and then you can communicate, like, if you have that skill, then I can, like, send you, like, pre-pros to all your other members and stuff like that, just like, hey, look at this idea I have, like, and you don't have to meet up every week for band practice to do it, like, you can just send it over the internet, like, Facebook, just MP3 it, like, hey guys, listen to this, then you get your feedback there, like,
Yeah.
All right. Well, I might be calling in you. We're definitely gonna be calling this guy. We're just trying to learn this as best as we possibly can.
So. I will help you best I can.
And we actually, I think I told you guys I have about my
your
Doom
buddy,
Drum Freedoms. We've got all of the not only mics but sound stuff as well.
Yeah, that's right,
so
yeah.
Whatever we can do, because we're probably gonna have to put my drums in the back room so that we can't hear traffic.
Yeah.
Dave's gonna be doing scratch tracks from my bathroom.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we're gonna have to finagle all that stuff. We're gonna need.
I'm all doing backup vocals in my car and shit.
But anyways, we just want it to be, and we want to learn the skills so that we can help other bands.
You know, there's a YouTube channel that I already mentioned earlier, but it's like super good for anything you want to record. He does use digital drums. He uses Superior Drummer, but
is this the Irish guy?
No, it's the Irish guy. Yeah,
the Scottish one.
The things that he says about drums totally apply into real life. So what he all the things that he's trying to convey like totally apply. The YouTube channel is called For Tiori.
You're gonna write it down.
Yeah, I'll send it to Facebook for you guys or something like that. It's like the best quality of videos that you can have on like recording metal, basically, like that I've seen. He's super educated, has very well versed vocabulary about things, and he really breaks it down into like the science of things, like frequencies and how they react and stuff like that. So I'll totally give that to you guys, like send you links and stuff like that, because it helped me out a shit ton.
Cool. Yeah, we, I mean, we're barely into this DVD. We watched the intro when we started watching guitars, but when you only have an hour and a half every week, and I mean, you want to play too, it's like it's gonna
even
take
putting on when you go to sleep. Like that's what I did. Like I would be
that's
so fucking
point.
Tired from work all day, and then playing music, and then I would just like my computer set up to my TV.
Because you're
so
subconscious
like,
is still getting this shit.
Yeah, so I put on you know like how to record jet guitars or something like that, and so like I would actually go to sleep to it and just like watch him like dabble in like plugins and stuff like that, but. And, like, I learned from it. So.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's a good idea. Okay. Let's see. Was there anything else I wanted to touch on? All right, so you tell us a little bit about user lives, because I actually don't know so much about that. I've seen Transient Dawn.
Right.
We played with you guys at Spring Meltdown. We were blown away. Watched your videos.
The entire fucking bar was blown away, dude.
Yeah, dude. People were coming
really awesome
you
show.
Always
people were, like, poking in from the bar. They were like, what is happening?
When people are leaving their alcohol to come watch the
yeah.
band, instead of the other way around going, all right, I've seen this.
We
go
were,
to the bar.
We were incredibly afraid of that crowd, too, because it was, like, all, like, metalhead biker jacket dudes.
A
and like,
of, yeah,
and we're just like,
yeah,
oh,
yeah.
shit, we're going to, like, play our pussy music to these guys.
No, man. I think you guys got to play three songs in your 25-minute set.
It was actually four songs, but, like,
wow, really?
Like the way
together?
The way we handle it is tying them together, like just do, like, while Todd has time to switch the backtrack. That he's going for, like the click track that he's going for, because he has them all on his phone, and then he just plugs in his headphones straight into his phone.
I don't feel so bad about recording this on my phone then, man.
Yeah.
If he's doing his click track in the pre-pro from his phone on live
shows, that's awesome.
Yeah, I just record an MP3, give him that as his click track, and then he plugs it in, and then he's good to go.
Awesome. Nice.
But like, we were so afraid to play to that crowd, like it was like crazy. I don't know.
No, it was.
We were just like everyone's
crazy.
Gonna hate us.
They were good.
No, I think that was Reno's first taste of Transit.
Yeah,
that was his first
yeah,
show.
It was
first
yeah,
show.
It was
yeah,
first show.
Exactly.
At
so.
A festival, like.
Yeah, no. And who was it? Octopus.
Cyborg Octopus.
Cyborg Octopus.
Did they play that same night?
They
no,
played
the
they
next
played
day.
The
next
day.
Right, okay.
Awesome.
Okay, look, I miss Flub, I miss Cyborg Octopus, I miss Awaiting the Apocalypse, I missed Ghoul, I missed all of these bands. And, I mean, I was super stoked to have seen Inanimate Existence, because they headlined that night for Friday. Which was phenomenal. Dude, they ended their set at like 1:30 in the morning and people were leaving and I was just like,
what?
I couldn't move. Like, I was in the booth and I'm still doing this.
What a huge, like,
but,
lineup for that show. There were so many
bands.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, I had to go to the small stage for a lot of them. I basically stayed on the.
We were fortunate to get on that big stage. Like,
right.
I'll tell you, because that small stage was tiny.
Oh,
yeah,
we played it.
And it was something.
The
dude,
at the bar?
My bass
yeah,
rig has
yeah.
never been so loud than it was
that
first
that,
time
that
we
was
played.
The first,
yeah.
That was the first time you used that bass.
Yeah, and it was
so.
Just like, yeah, and I was
we
like,
got,
oh,
we got done playing,
rad.
And I was like, hey, you guys sounded pretty good, but the bass was too much.
That's
and I was
what
I like, yeah, he just got that. Let him have his moment. Like, it sounded, it sounds great. So
I still played well, so
yeah,
whatever.
I came in at, like, the last part of your guys' set, because we went and dropped up all
so
our equipment.
So that's why he likes us, all right? That's why he's like, well, all right, Lindsay, after he hasn't heard us yet.
I like you guys.
I came in for like the last two songs because we had dropped off our equipment back
right.
at MRC because we didn't want it like hanging out and stuff
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, exactly.
So, so we drop off the equipment. I come catch you guys and I just see Brian like in like full fucking like Kevlar gear.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Singing.
We give him shit and say that he looks like he's about to go fishing.
Yeah,
fishing gear.
Yeah,
he catches
fishers,
a lot of shit for that.
Fisherman jacket.
No, I mean he's one of my favorite frontmen in Reno though. So
yeah,
Brian is
we give him shit. He's a great lyricist.
Yeah, he's great.
And his vocal range is fucking off the hook.
But I'm telling
yeah.
you, Brian, you earned the shit we give you, man.
Yeah.
True.
Dude will send you random pictures of his asshole. For real.
Like,
I'm
legit.
Talking,
we
talking,
all... No.
I'm not talking his ass. I'm talking
just,
the stink guy.
Just the asshole. Dude, we opened up our phones and all of us were like, what the fuck?
Come on, Brian. He got four consecutive. Come on, Brian. What the hell?
Oh, my God. Yeah,
I mean, my initial reaction, I was like, ha, 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 don't do that again. Like,
which is instantly gonna get you another picture. Of his
yeah,
side,
yeah. But it was just this thing that
just
was...
winking the side.
Dude,
oh God,
terrible.
It's
all right, so back to
so, yeah,
user
like
user
lives main project now. I'm like I've got pretty much the entire album written. Like so,
and are you?
finding a drummer for this, or are you
See, that's
programming
the thing,
the
is what I'm going to do is I'm going to release the album, so it's just me and Andrew from Florida.
Right.
I need to wait for him to write lyrics, because he maybe joined the project maybe a
couple
weeks ago.
How many tracks are you, is this an EP?
It's,
is it full
it's
length?
Seven tracks.
Okay.
So it's like between that area of EP and full length. I'm just going to call it...
It's EP track-wise, but it's full length time-wise.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, it's got seven tracks on it. We were talking about collaborating for an eighth track. We want to release it before the end of the year, but like I'm all about quality, and so if it needs to extend beyond the end of the year, I'm perfectly fine with that. I'd rather be done right than.
But dude, he's still doing all these videos and stuff. He's smart. This is the thing. I'm talking like he's not even here. He's really smart about content
promotion. Yeah.
Continually keeping your people talking about you.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing.
Not oversaturation, but being like, all right, it's been. In a couple weeks, let's put something new out there. Or
it's,
have you watched this yet?
It's I'm actually extremely fortunate not to be hooked by a label right now, because I can build up hype very easily without a label. So, like, essentially, any song I want, I can make a playthrough of and put it up on the internet without a label approval. So, and I plan to do that for every single User Lives song. Like, I plan to do a live playthrough
and as you
front
do that,
to back.
When you put it online, that's instant copyright as well.
That's instant copyright, and not only that, it... Like, it's content.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, so many bands run out of content so fast because they shove their album out. It's like, like the hype ends after a little bit. Mm-hmm. Like you get those rare cases like Fallujah where people are still talking about Flesh Prevails a year later.
Yeah.
Like, and if you have content to constantly push, you have constant promotion.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's another problem, is you need to make sure you don't burst it all out in one thing. Like, bursty content is very harmful. It's why the way albums are set up is kind of difficult, because you release all your content at once, like, here you guys go, like, here's all of it.
That's the old school method. That's the old
right.
school
yeah.
thing.
It's,
yeah.
it's an industry standard way of doing it, but it's not the most effective in
but
my
But things
opinion.
Have changed. The industry has completely changed.
In the last 3 months, I have gained 5,000 likes on Facebook just by posting videos on forums. I think I've only made four videos. Four videos I've made, and I've gotten 5,000 likes. So if I attribute that to, like,
yeah.
1,000 and change per video, that's really well, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
So if I do that with the good production on top of that, because anything anybody's heard is all pre-pros.
It's like, dude, but you're talking to people who are like, dude, we get 30 likes in a month, and I'm like, oh!
Yeah.
Like,
still, I mean, I totally understand. This is the
yeah.
thing I also say, is that we're practicing once a week. We play one show a month, if that. We're not super out there. We're doing with this Tea Time for LOTA thing. That was my whole goal, was to be like, let's
push content.
Content.
Yeah.
It's all. I listen to podcasts all day
right.
at work, and I'm like, content. Keep them talking about you. And yeah.
And I've had more and more people in the last like month just be like, I watched your Tea Time with LOTA. I loved it. You guys were there. I watched the one, and then I watched all of them.
I think the most views we've got on any of them is like 83. I would like to see it go over 100. But sorry, this
no,
episode,
actually,
unless
I think
you're pushing it as well to all your people.
I'll post it.
This episode is probably going to get maybe 50 to 100. I'm trying to get us out there and stuff, but the likes are, since we're not playing that much. The likes on our page.
There's definitely a chain of things you need to do for promotion. First, you need to write the songs. Then you need to record the songs. Then you need to like give those to the public somehow. Whether it's just an MP3 online through SoundCloud or Facebook or whatever. But like I found the most effective way is just video playthroughs. People like especially like the instant uploads to Facebook. Because they autoplay as you're scrolling down your news feed.
Yeah.
And when people see you playing some fucking badass instrument and like stuff like that, they're gonna click the video.
Yeah.
And then when if the like whether they like what you're playing or not is like debatable once they actually click it. Because I get a ton
but
of hate
who cares,
as well.
As long as they're clicking.
Right. As long as they click it, they saw you somehow. Like, there's this like guy Mike Reed in town. Actually, he didn't know that I was in town. And he shared one of the User Lives videos, and he's just like, oh, this fucking bullshit, this is just like...
Oh, no, I know Mike, he's a good friend.
Yeah.
His mom just died.
He basically, like...
I remember that.
Shit-talked my video, and I'm just like, dude, like...
Did you guys
like,
make up?
I just messaged him on Facebook, I'm like, sorry you didn't like my video, dude. Like, I hope everything's not awkward.
Oh, the whole comment thread, remember that, yeah.
Where everyone was just going to town on Mike for what he said.
Because there was a lot, like, there was a lot...
What he said, I did not agree with.
Like, there was a lot that I just was like, I should just go on a rant. Just make this guy cry, but then I was like, nah.
I was just like you know, like whatever. Even then, even Mike hated my video, and he still shared it.
Mm-hmm.
What if his friends like my video?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. He's promoting what he doesn't like.
That's where Rings of Saturn is brilliant, because their controversy, even though somebody doesn't like them, maybe everyone else does.
Right.
Like,
Saturn is fun.
This is the thing, as I was, because I did not contribute to that discussion.
Right.
I read a lot, because there were like hundreds.
Oh, yeah.
There
was a lot of it. My whole, because I know Mike and I know you, I like what Mike's doing with his bands. I love what you're doing with your bands. The thing is, why does it have to be one way or the other? Can't it be
the thing?
It's just, it's like, even if there's a tinge of like...
Exactly, it looked like you guys made up. Like, he was going on,
well,
but other people will start to attack him, and you were just like, okay, whatever.
The thing about it for me was, it's just like, I had nothing against Mike. I've never met Mike. Like, and so, like, he shares my video, and then, like, I'm just like, oh, sorry you didn't like my video, dude. I messaged him personally. I'm just like if you don't like my music, like I'm sorry, like totally go for it. And then, like he thinks that I'm like threatening him and somehow and something like that.
Message?
Yeah, and like he keeps going.
Did
on.
Did he hear sarcasm or what?
Like, I don't think he got the sarcasm. Like, I posted my screenshots in the comments. Like,
yeah, I saw those too.
But like it just seemed like he was angsty and stubborn and didn't want to like really, you know, like.
Except the fact that it was just like a,
The thing about negativity in music is it's just very toxic. Like,
yeah.
You should never be negative, period. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Like, and I got that a little bit from Mike. I didn't really particularly care, but because he still shared my video. What do I care? Like,
right.
But, like, at the same time, if I was, like, 18-year-old Charlie, I probably would have, like
gone off
on him. But that's not healthy. That's completely not healthy.
Because then you're adding to the toxicity.
Exactly. Well, if you're struggling so hard to defend yourself as well, you're just like, oh,
I
whatever,
what
dude.
Did
like,
there.
You just see what
yeah.
I mean? The system of a town.
Yeah.
It all comes back to system of a town.
Darren. There's something really douchey about defending yourself too much as well.
Oh, I agree.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
that's so true.
Like,
just let people think what they're gonna think.
Like, I'll still do it to my friends though. Like, I'll defend my friends like to the death. Like, somebody was posting hate comments on Matt's Archspire tryout video, and I was just like, "Fuck you, dude!" Like Matt's like super good. Like, I was defending him like completely, but like for my own music, like I shouldn't have to like, you know, explain myself.
Yeah.
I
make
the
music I make, and if you don't like it, it wasn't made for you.
Stop listening.
Yeah.
For every one
of
you that doesn't like it, like 400 other people are gonna be like, "That is so rad, dude! You're super talented."
Even if they don't like the music, they can just recognize the fucking skill that it takes to be.
But people,
people
gotta have, they gotta troll,
they
gotta have something to say.
That's why
you posted about that. I remember you posting the comment where you're like, "Oh, you know what? Fuck negativity. I'm not gonna post anything that's negative anymore." I remember you posted.
Yeah.
And I had a lot of respect for that. You know, I'm like, oh shit, I post too many negative.
Well,
it's made me think about
it's
me.
Incredibly easy to do. Like, you find yourself just doing it, like, even though you don't even think about it. Like
it was,
I mean,
what's that word? It's
cunt? Oh, sorry.
Angel,
when you say C, that's what's
Angel
that
Vivaldi recently made a video about just negativity in music, where like he tagged like Nickelback and Rings of Saturn and all these super controversial bands, and he's just like what the fuck are you doing? Like, you're just sitting on your like computer just bitching about it on the internet. You could be playing your instruments. Like,
I posted that about Nickelback. I'm like, you guys are bagging on Nickelback, but they're counting their money right now, laughing at you.
The thing is you have every right to not like something, but like when you're just vehemently spreading hate on the internet, you're just toxic. Like, get the fuck out. Like
I can understand the whole, like, there's that huge just uprising about Nickelback that literally just like sprouted, and then everybody was like, yeah, actually, you know what? We don't like Nickelback. Like, fuck Nickelback. And then it turned into like a
meme.
It
turned into a
bandwagon. And then it turned into,
and
it turned into a bandwagon, and everybody's like, yeah, fuck Nickelback, blah, 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 blah.
Not everybody, man. I'm over here going, I have all their albums. I listen to them and I get pumped up.
The thing, like I said, you have every right to say, like, it's not my thing. Like, but, like, why would you just post something? Be like, fuck Nickelback. Like,
fuck anyone who listens to them.
Right.
Yeah,
I fucking hate Wind Direction.
It's like almost like those like religious zealots of whatever religion you have, where it's just like, dude, you don't believe the same thing as me. You're a fucking idiot. Like,
just the fucking look that I got from you, man. That's all.
He's like, oh yeah, fuck religion.
Like,
because here's the thing. Like, growing up, like, I grew up in a very Christian background, and that's what I believe in, everything like that, and Tunic is like, he grew up in the same background, kind of, but he's very atheist. But we have discussions. We're like, we'll fight, but we have a lot of discussions about it. And it was just funny when he brought it up. The look he gave me was like... And I'm like, I've never once just been like, ah!
You fucking fedora tipping piece of shit!
Jesus, motherfucker.
No, I told him he needs Jesus a thousand times.
Why do you shave your neck beard?
Beard.
Dude, we don't mention beards around Sammy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He gets sensitive.
It's okay. All I can grow is the chin. That's all I got. Like,
he can't even grow that.
Yes, I can a little bit.
He gets like half a mix of stash.
It looks like
you
got like sideburns right in here, though.
I can grow some mean chops if I want to. I just don't have the patience for that shit.
It takes like 6 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, like 6 minutes.
Yeah.
Alright, so User Lives, you have an album, you're trying to get 7 songs.
Yeah, hopefully,
by the end of this year.
Hopefully before the end of the year, if all goes according to plan. And then we search for labels and then other members after that. So I'm guessing release the album, search for other members right after that.
Are you doing just, well, if he's in Florida.
I want to build it into a touring band. So,
right, so you can take a national.
But it needs to be big enough that it's worth it for us.
Are you looking for a label for just distribution, or are you looking for a label for the record deal?
Probably promotion,
so you can
distribution.
Get your 20 cents per album.
The thing is like if like the record deal is shitty, I'm not going to take it because I can promote myself.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like,
just be smart about it.
Yeah, and so you don't want to sign your death warrant, basically.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I'll sign a 6 record deal.
Yeah.
What you mean? You guys are getting my merch sales on the road too?
Yeah, exactly. So. Like, right now, I'm sort of, like, anti-label, like, a little bit, unless the deal is really good.
To me, for a DIY bands, you can get a good recording, you know, on your computer, on your laptop. Distro. All you need is someone to get it into stores.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need someone to give you the money, to front you the money, so you can get in the studio for a month to put out a product.
Right.
Which,
just,
my vocalist owns a distribution label.
Boom.
Bam.
Now,
there
what
you
know to me, though?
Yeah, he owns Hollow Records,
okay.
and
he's metal. Like
it's a metal record.
Metal.
Yeah,
right.
Like he Andrew Zick was previously in Ovid's Withering. He was in that band for 6 years, and that's
so sad they broke up.
Like, have you heard of Akeldama?
Huh.
Oh yeah, I have. Yeah, Akeldama is his main project. That's
is that how you pronounce that? I've never known. I've always said Akeldama.
No, it's Akeldama.
It's Akeldama.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I was the same thing until I heard it. I was just like, is that Akeldama? Like,
yeah, that's what
it's,
I thought.
It's more fun to say.
No,
it
was because
sure.
of it's because of the faceless. That was their first
you gotta,
album.
Like, you gotta puff your cheeks out while you do like Akeldama. So you get to do that. Like, you
like
can't
you
go
take
like Akeldama.
Akeldama.
I'm learning all kinds of new stuff today.
Offense Withering, man.
I know. What's
so
that story? I have also insider info into that. When the camera's off, we'll talk about that.
We are
that.
Talking about
yeah.
this, dude.
Such a bummer.
Poor
so,
Sammy.
Just,
yeah.
I just
swear, that's
he,
a, he
gets
more than
he
would
like.
He's
had
some terrible
happens. Like, fucking Tea Time with Loader number 2, we've talked about Ovid's Withering.
Almost every
not tonight, Sammy.
Yeah.
You are going to be happy.
Let it go.
Right?
I am happy. Have you heard their album? It's phenomenal. I want their second one so bad.
No, just stop.
All right.
Right there.
We're good. You never know. They might release it. I doubt it, but... Dude, put your ass down. Put your ass down. All right, is there anything else that we need to ask?
No,
I was
going
to ask
you
to be a part of the User Lives.
Guitar guy, Charlie.
I'm going
to release the tabs as soon as everything's
like
done,
now.
So I'll be looking
what?
For members as soon as the album's out.
Yeah,
I know
just
that I'm
going to
give up
on
guitar.
I'll send
yeah.
everybody. The thing is, I can't send anybody tabs until the album's out, or else like I run the risk of people stealing my shit.
Yeah,
exactly. But like I said, I mean, once you put it on the internet, you can prove.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, that's basically copyright. You can prove.
Yep.
Wasn't that something that you had to go through that one dude?
I thought, you know, but like my buddy Sims Cashin, who's also on Swix Pix, he convinced me otherwise. He's just like, no, dude, when you release a video, that timestamps it. Like, that's when you release that content.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody can fuck with you.
Someone
yeah.
else, I mean, if they're going to come after you, they got to prove that they had something similar
before
that.
And
if they can't. Dude,
somebody recently on one of the Instagram videos I uploaded, he actually just tapped it out 15 minutes to me later. Like, he like looked at it and he's just like, I do this for a living. I just tapped out your thing because I really liked it. And I'm just like, dude, in 15 minutes you did that? That's fucking awesome. Like,
yeah.
But like, that shows you how easy it is for somebody to steal your shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Do
it that quick.
Like, because he had it perfect. The tab was perfect.
Right.
You're all,
Oh my god, I didn't even think about... Wow, holy crap.
Yeah.
Nobody hears that little hammer-on right there. That's crazy.
Yeah, it was just like one major third off, and I'm just like, you had only this one thing wrong, and that was it. Like,
but why would you tell him?
I know, right?
It's wrong.
But like same thing. I posted it to Instagram. Nobody can steal it. So
yeah,
exactly. It used to be back in the day, you know, in the Stone Ages, where I'm from. It used to be you had to record it.
I just put keep it, picturing you like in medieval times.
Put it in a envelope. No, not even send it to a record label. You send it to yourself.
Oh,
and never
yeah.
opened it.
Oh,
and then it's copyrighted. That's legally copyrighted. That
we
was one of copyrighted
our songs.
Yeah.
We did that with one of our songs when I was in Descent when I was like 15 years old.
And even then, now that's like way too much work. All
exactly.
you gotta do is post a video.
Yeah,
and have a timestamp, and you're good.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
This I wrote this.
Yeah.
And got proof.
Yeah.
Forever.
Somebody else could be like, "Oh, it sounds like this," and you're like, "But it's fucking not." So, suck a dick.
And I'm not sure, like, for it to be classified as stolen, what percentage has to be?
I think it's if like.
You don't hear this. You guys are fucking yeah, exactly. You guys are fucking lucky you're not gonna be able to smell
it. Did you see his
tune? That's so bad.
Oh my god, I didn't know it was gonna be.
You know what? I wish. Did you shame yourself?
Can we copyright that?
Oh my god.
We're grabbing the tune. We were all quiet. He made sure we were all quiet. He stood up.
Oh my god.
What's he doing? Yeah, we gotta get a sample of that, dude. Kind of kick, if I'm doing the kick, it's like Alex Van Halen has his Corvette, which whatever, triggered into a kick.
Speaking of samples, like at the end of our show at PB&J's, I actually like went on my guitar's clean channel and I put this right up to my pickups and it was just like...
Dude, that sound is on the POD album. They use a
similar
sample
to pick up. Like, that was so funny.
What happened to his face? I don't know.
Dude. I was like,
did that really happen?
Like, it looked like somebody had told him they just raped the cat.
I was just like, I hope I don't get blamed for this.
Dude, there's no way, not with him going like
no, I didn't move because I just like, I like adjusted this way and I was like,
no,
oh god, and it's all free. And I was like,
oh. You didn't move willingly, you were lifted.
You did move. I think
this has gone on too far.
No, it's not too far. People, this is what they want. This is the quality.
Somebody's gonna laugh at this.
Literally every piece of the puzzle is in this.
Everyone gets
one
ass farts. Listen, we had some. We had some history. Some of Charlie's history. We saw how he came along as a guitar player, as a singer. We didn't know that.
Farting just polished it off.
Yeah, we had that. We had
we'll go with that.
His band's history.
You know what's funny is I feel like women are gonna laugh more about that fart than men.
Yeah.
I did not see that coming.
That's gonna be
the guys are gonna be like, really, bro?
I want to see the playback of Sammy's face when he's just like, where he gets progressively more concentrated. Like,
you can
I'm off.
Like, he's not listening to the conversation. He's just completely immersed,
totally zoomed out. That's going to be the new Tea Time with LOTA introduction song.
You know how like some bands will start with like a fucking bell hit right before it comes in? Like, it'll just save his ass. Like,
I'll do a drum fill, and instead of hitting that little bell that I have, it'll be... Way to go, Sammy.
We'll just put a mic up to you on stage, and it'll be the same experience.
No, I'm actually stoked that we got some technical talk in there, too. Some people might be turned off by that, but that's the kind of stuff that gets my motor.
It's so important.
Yeah. But, so hopefully some people can watch it and learn some stuff as well. I mean, I learned some stuff tonight.
I just want to hear that playback.
If you can make it through an hour and 45 minutes...
What are we at right now?
Hour and 57 minutes.
God.
2 hours. If you can
make
it for 2 hours...
Biscuits.
Good luck.
Yeah. Oh, dude, as soon as I upload this tomorrow, I'm going to start it as soon as we're done, but it's going to take until tomorrow. Yeah, I'll be watching it. Like,
oh, yeah.
No sleep till Brooklyn tonight, so...
Yeah.
So I'm going to skip to about an hour and 45 minutes.
You should timestamp it in the comments, like,
Wait for surprise.
Find the exact time when it happens and just title it skip to set.
Yeah. We definitely need a title for this. What is the title going to be?
Charlie Rules. Nah. Teach me Charlie.
Teach Me Charlie?
No.
Teach Me Charlie.
Perhaps Charlie bit my finger.
Ass of the Arbitrator?
Ass of the Arbitrator.
Limbs of the Ass.
Hey, no, don't give him this because he'll be doing this.
Oh, yeah.
I was building something. I remember there was one episode of Tea Time with Lotta where, like, I don't know if it was Sammy or Phil, where, like, you're unscrewed it and Jeremy's just waiting for it.
I see him twisting his shit and I'm like, oh man, he's gonna. I know what he's doing.
And I was completely unaware.
As soon as I shut off, I was just like, I knew it!
And my reaction was like, oh!
Good stuff. Well, I just want to thank you for driving down with your
Charlie and the tea time
coolant
factory.
Leaking car.
Oh, it's all good.
Duh!
Third good idea.
Charlie and the tea time factory.
Okay.
I like
that's
it.
That's it. Tea time with LOTA number 7.
Charlie and the tea time factory. God.
Sounds good. Dude, hey, you said you were out of ideas. You said you had reached your quota.
You fucking lied, man.
Fucking piece of
you
shit.
You have no idea how hard it was for you to reach me for that one.
This goes on as tomorrow's idea.
Absolutely.
Yeah. We're borrowing it.
That's right. It's a borrow. I've loaned it.
Yeah. All. Exactly.
Gotta pay for it tomorrow.
Thank you for
absolutely.
It has been a privilege.
Thank you.
Dude, I saw the guy, and here's how we shook hands.
Appreciate it. Thank you guys for tuning in. If you made it through, did you shut it off already?
Nah, there was a 20% battery warning. I was just dismissing it. Don't worry about me.
My phone started at like 85% and it's going down to 20%. That's insane. Anyways, thank you guys for watching it. If you made it all the way to this part where I'm thanking you, you could check out Charlie's shit on what sites?
Facebook.com/theuserlives, and you can do facebook.com/transientdong. I think I have Twitter accounts and, you know, SoundClouds for all of them as well, so, yeah, check that shit out.
Awesome.
Do it!
Do it. Yeah. Thank you so much, thank you, Tunic Dick, for filming.
Why you guys call me a dick for?
Every time, why you gotta... Anyways, thank you for filming, thank you, Zev, for being here.
Absolutely.
I love
for
you.
Having me.
Love you, too, bro.
I love you.
I love you.
No homo.
I love you.
I mean, pause.
I love you.
Cock dang it. I love you.
I love you too.
Oh, that should have been the thing, dude.
Cock magnet?
Yeah, Charlie and the
cock magnet.
All right,
everyone point.
Oh, that's what I was thinking.
Thank you. See you next time.